Hanu, come up to the table if you're in here in the room. You can, yeah, if you want to sit up here, that would be great. Oh, there you are. Hi, Donovan. Aaron Benker, are you here? Yes. If you guys want to all come up now, that would be great. Okay, that's your stuff. I won't touch that. Confining space. All right.
Kind of like church, no one sits in the front row.
Yeah, it's always that way. They're scared, intimidated by the speakers. All right. If you want to take your seats, we can get started on time. All right. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. How's the sound in the back? Everybody can hear okay? You can see okay? Dan, was that thumbs up or down? Thumbs up. All right, good. Well, I want to start out by apologizing on behalf of Mother Nature for the ill-timed snow. And I'm really thrilled that we have so many of you here, but I think we're going to see people trickling in. I've heard reports that 35E South was terrible, 35E was North was terrible. Anything about 94 West, folks coming in from the West? Okay, and a lot of them are still out there. Not too much we can do about that. I'm really grateful that we could find this larger space to accommodate the 190 people that registered for this event. My name is Martha Faust, and I'm the Executive Director of Minnesota Brownfields. And I want to welcome you all to today's Vapor Intrusion Forum. For those who aren't familiar with us, Minnesota Brownfields is a 501c3 nonprofit organization, and our mission is to promote the efficient cleanup and reuse of contaminated land throughout Minnesota through education, research, and partnerships. And as I did last time, I'd like to welcome first-time attendees and newcomers. For how many of you, this is your first Minnesota Brownfields event? Show of hands. Okay, we're still getting new people. That's amazing. Most of the folks that registered for the February 2nd kickoff session are here today. So in terms of the Venn diagram, it's nearly perfect overlap, but not quite. And I want to also give a huge thank you to the sponsors of this series, Braun Intertech, Home Safety Solutions, Bar Engineering, Terracon, Pace Analytical, and Bay West. If you could join me in giving them a round of applause. Next, I'd like to introduce or recognize our board members and advisory committee members that are in attendance. So if you're a Minnesota Brownfields board member, could you please stand up? Mary, Meredith, Marcus. Hi, Marcus. Hi, Margaret. And then our advisory committee members, if you can stand up. Got a number of folks here as well. So for those of you in the room, if you want to connect with folks about what Minnesota Brownfields is doing or give us feedback, as well as staff, those folks are good to talk to. And then I'd like to recognize our individual and organizational members. So if you are a member of Minnesota Brownfields or your organization is, can I have you stand up? This is where it's more of an audience participation thing. Fantastic. Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. So as I said last time, I'll say it again today, events like this one have been especially crafted to meet your needs. We hope we're meeting the mark. When I opened my Minneapolis Star Tribune paper on Sunday and saw vapor intrusion just below the fold on page one on the cover, I thought, yep, I think this is a timely event. I'm sure you'll all agree. So if you value this kind of programming and you aren't already a member, we would ask you to please consider membership. We have a couple of upcoming events I want to reference. We're going to kind of go quiet for a little while, and then May 18th, we're going to be doing a Brownfields 101 session at the City of St. Cloud in conjunction with the city and with the St. Cloud Area Chamber of Commerce. So there'll be more information coming out about that soon. On May 25th, we'll be doing a Brownfields Summit through the Minnesota Real Estate Journal. And so look for more information on that. And then our June State of Brownfields update is always well received. I would like to thank all of the speakers today. And in the interest of time and to preserve as much time as possible for Q&A, I'm not going to read everybody's bios. So hopefully everybody grabbed one of those sheets on their way in. Want to thank all of them for participating today and all of the work that went into their presentations. And I would like to give special thanks to Board Member Mary Sands and from our advisory committee, Steve Jansen and Chris Thompson, and especially Steve Jansen, who was working on questions for our panel well into the early hours of the morning on Tuesday. So thank you so much to all of you for your time in helping shape this program. We said last time our learning objectives were really to help get everybody up to speed, raise the bar on your general level of knowledge, and also to talk about some of the issues and conflicts that you're all experiencing, what's working well, where's there room to improve, and to talk about case studies, kind of where the rubber hits the road, how all of this is playing out for you from a project standpoint, and with a focus on brownfield sites. All of the presentations that we're going to kick off next are on our website or will be there. So we'll have that. And then for the first time today in our history, we are recording this event. So for folks that want to be able to access a recording later, I'll have instructions shortly on how to do that. So with that, I would like to call up our first speaker. And what we're going to do, according to your agenda, is we've got three case studies that are going to be presented. First, Chris, and then Donovan, and I think last is Aaron. They're going to come up and each give their case studies. We'll hold question and answers until the end, and then we'll have some good time for Q&A afterwards. So with that, our first speaker is Chris Thompson of Braun Intertech.
Peer engineering, former Geomatrix, and existing Braun Intertech staff, and we've all come about this from different background and experience, and we realize that there's a lot of mitigation design work of different styles, different types, and so forth. And then Minnesota Brownfields was also going to do a seminar, and we've joined with them to jointly do this, and combined with other consultants and with the PCA and. So it's morphed a little bit, but still we're trying to focus on mitigation, design, experience, and how it informs us going forward. So I'm going to focus my on my experience with industrial commercial sites and vapor mitigation systems, a little bit of vapor remediation also. So these have ranged from basic vapor barrier membranes to passive and active systems. I have a background in industrial ventilation design, some HVAC system design and SVE system design and implementation, and that sort of informed my approach to vapor mitigation. And I've been doing vapor mitigation projects here in Minnesota since, well, the first one I think I installed was in 1996 at the former Joslin site redevelopment project. I've also done this in some other states, including California, which is a fairly highly regulated state. So my approach to design and mitigation systems is informed, again, by my background in moving fluids, in this case air, but also EPA and some state guidance on design documents, which we don't really yet have, although we're in the beginning stages of that for some of the work we're doing. So today I'm going to focus on these engineered systems and what time we have available, sub-slab ventilation systems for new building construction on brownfield sites, industrial commercial buildings. And as I was saying, really sort of the three main mitigation systems that EPA and a number of other states sort of default to are basic barrier membranes, sub-slab depressurization systems, which has been a lot of talk about those here recently, and then sub-slab ventilation systems, which is what I'm going to focus on. There are other techniques, other actions one can take in conjunction or standalone with these systems, and such as pressurizing indoor spaces, floor coverings, dilution of indoor air, and that type of thing. Steve Flayton from my office, Braun, spoke last at our last seminar a little bit about building design and functions and how that might inform us going forward on mitigation systems. He had a lot to present in a short period of time, so I hope that those of you that were there at least got something out of that. So if you look at, there's been EPA guidance. I think the most recent guidance was updated in 2015. This is really kind of the wording you get out of that guidance. You can have a vapor mitigation system, which is simply a barrier. Sort of contrary, I think, to some of the attitudes or discussions that we've had recently as a group. Sub-slab depressurization systems. This is the terminology. This is the wording that you'll get out of some of these other guidance or, in some case, state rules. So we've talked a lot about sub-slab depressurization. Sub-slab ventilation, what I'm going to talk about today, is all about removing vapors, diluting them and moving up from that sub-slab zone. But it also can include more than just mitigation. It can include remediation of the potential source that you may have under your building. Something I thought I would point out that in some of my preparation for today is that CERCLA and RCRA sites under EPA oversight, this preemptive mitigation that all of a sudden is a kind of a big topic. And the EPA is very quick to go to prevent preemptive mitigation where there's potentially a pathway to exposure or future actions may create that pathway. And it seemed appropriate, even though it's a little out of context in some respects. So sub-slab ventilation systems. they can be passive or they can be active. And I think there's a little bit of uncertainty in what those terms mean. We'll talk about that a little bit. And as I said before, it can be just dealing with the vapor that's gotten to that sub-slab zone, or it can be also partly a remediation system for source control or source removal. Components of these systems, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some drawings, I'm going to show you some pictures of components of these systems and get to a concept of how it works and a little discussion of some of the findings. So this subslab zone, you need to bring fresh air into that zone. You've got some kind of vent layer, typically under the barrier membrane. You've got some header piping, it's perforated piping to help direct your flows. You need to discharge that collected air, typically above the roof of a building, and then you have some kind of a discharge stack, and I'll explain that a little bit more. For a mechanical system, you also have some kind of either wind-driven or electrical fan. So therein is the difference between a passive or an active system. The passive system allowing natural thermal or wind-driven induced flow versus wind-driven fans or electrical fans. So some of the system components, it's a little hard to see these, I realize. This is from some design drawings at a truck dock wall of an industrial building where this fresh air inlet is at the face of the truck dock. Or if you have, to the left is the outside wall of the building, and there, the floor of the building's on the inside. Somehow you gotta get that fresh air inside and underneath the barrier membrane. So just some photographs. If you look closely, you can see that little white dot right there. Sorry, I can't hold this steady. That literally is the fresh air inlet, but there's a series of them around the building. If you look closely at it, it's just a little pipe that protrudes out with some kind of screen to keep the little critters from climbing in there. The above ground fresh air inlet may look something like that. This is a recent building, and you can just see, you can just see right there, one of a number of points where we're bringing fresh air in under the floor. Again, sort of a screened opening, keep out birds and squirrels. So now you're looking down at the building, and you're seeing below the floor, and this building is 720 feet long, and it's 180 feet wide. I can't remember exactly, or 180 feet deep. And what you're seeing in the blue piping is that's connected to all those fresh air inlets. We've got a sort of a perimeter circle, if you will, of perforated piping. It's all fresh air at ambient pressure. We also bring it into the center of the building with hard piping to the perforated piping indicated as dashed line. The red piping is all connected to the exhaust, if you will. And so in a second, you'll see sort of how this functions. So that's a passive system. There are, in this case, six roof vents there, and I forget how many fresh air inlets around the perimeter of the building. Here we have an active system. We're bringing fresh air in two points at the truck dock wall, and we're hard piping it all the way around to the far wall of the building, again under the floor, and then we're drawing air where it says vent riser pipe there in the middle through this perforated pipe here. And you'll see a few details on this in a second. So that's an active system where we actually have a fan on this system, or we will. The vent layer. The vent layer is what your piping is connected to or is constructed within. Typically, it's been a vent sand, maybe 6 inches of sand. And in this case, there's sort of a definition of the grain size distribution. What you don't want is a lot of fines, which is typically that number 200 sieve number right there. We've also used something called a geocomposite. It's about a quarter inch thick. It's a geofabric adhered to what looks like almost a snow fence material, that fiberglass or plastic material. It's very porous, and you can lay that down underneath this whole floor of this building, and you can draw air through it. And if you don't have a lot of space on which to create this section that you're trying to vent, that can actually work pretty darn well. So you have this vent layer. Here's a cross-section of a recent system that we just installed. The concrete floors of the building is there. In this case, it's 7 inches thick. Then we have 6 inches of a class 5 material that supports that floor. Then we have a geotextile material that's there simply to protect this vapor barrier. In this case, Raven Industries vapor barrier membrane with our 6 inches of sand in which we've placed this header piping, either the fresh air piping or the extraction piping. And then we've got, in this case, at this building, we had excess class 5. It was recycled concrete. And then our soils below, some of which are contaminated, and down at depth, which you can't see, is the contaminated groundwater. With both soil and groundwater, with, in this case, the TCE impacts. So here's during the construction. At this building, you have this sand layer, which is a little hard to tell, but it's 6 inches thick. We're putting this piping in here. It's perforated like a drain tile pipe. It's inside of a fabric sock to keep out sand from getting in the pipe. Then the membrane is laid down and sealed. I don't show that, but it's sealed to the walls, sealed to the columns. Here's a picture then with the geotextile, which is placed down to protect the membrane, and it's being placed and graded, and that, again, that ends up being, that's that class 5 material being placed to about a 6-inch thickness, over which then the concrete floor is poured. Those vents that, in the passive system, they have to rise up, and they typically rise up along the column. In this case, we actually have a site where we have more soil between the floor and its supporting material and the membrane. In this case, it was about 18 inches of material. We lowered the membrane in that building. And here it's a little hard to see, but the vent riser pipe literally rises up and goes through the roof. And in this case, we have what we call a no-loss discharge stack, which is a defined dimensions of this pipe, which, believe it or not, rain doesn't fall straight down. And this keeps the air, it discharges out of this pipe. Wind traveling across, say, left or right, creates a vacuum at the head of the pipe and will draw air from all the way under that floor, from all the way at those fresh air inlets. So this is a passive system when we use one of these discharge stacks. We also use them on active systems to keep rain out of the fan that you may have. And it operates more efficiently than a typical roof stack where you may see a little plate that's mounted across the top of the pipe. Anyways, here's what one of these things looks like on the roof. In fact, you can see one here. There's another one over there. And there may be some in the background you just can't quite see. So again, this happens to be this passive system on top of a roof. And I forget the square footage of this building. Caitlin, you should know this. 133,000 square foot building. Okay, thanks. So this happens to be one of those stacks on an active system at a very small retail site right over by Lake Calhoun. And again, it's constructed quite a ways off the roof so that we don't get re-entrainment of those discharge vapors into the building, either the building HVAC system or into a doorway leading into that building. It's something that can be designed based on assumed building dimensions and wind directions and wind speeds and so forth. That's why it happens to be quite a ways in the air. What you can't see is that's the top of the roof parapet. This is not a very good picture. It's the only one I had, though. A rotary roof vent or a rotary roof ventilator, people call them by different names, don't pay attention to, they just happen to be located right here. This thing is in transit. It shouldn't be even in the picture. But again, the wind, you've seen these things in all sorts of situations, perhaps. That thing turns around quite fast. It has a defined flow that it will draw. It's a fan. It just happens to be driven by the wind, which gets to a discussion about, well, how often should these systems work? And we don't have time to talk about that right now. It really gets into a discussion that is, on one hand, very technical, on the other hand, it's just something we're not prepared to talk about yet. This happens to be an active system. And it's a recent one we've been working on. It's a little hard to tell because it's a very busy picture, but we have this fan, regenerative blower, that's drawing air from a number of points within the building through an air, a water air separator, and then it discharges through a silencer and then up to the roof. So here's a little cartoon we put together that I'm trying to show you how these systems work, whether they're passive or whether they're active. And if this happens to be, I used the one that I showed the floor plan earlier where we're bringing the fresh air in at the truck docks. I just didn't put the piping that leads from where you see the red piping all the way over to where it says fresh air to subslab piping. So we didn't put the fresh air in over there because it would have been right in front of the doorways of this building. So that's why we plumbed it from the truck dock area all the way around to the far side of the building. So I don't know from your angle what this looks like. From my angle, it's a little distorted, but literally we're bringing that fresh air in along that header pipe where there's larger blue arrows. It's perforated pipe, so that air is being drawn. So we have a fan in the system where it says vent riser pipe. So we're creating a vacuum everywhere where there's those big red arrows. That vacuum is then inducing flow all the way from the fresh air inlets through the perforated piping, through the sand where you've got all those little teeny arrows coming across there. So that, in concept, is what's going on with a subslab ventilation system. Anyways. So again, that's under the floor, under the membrane, in that vent layer. So just a couple of points I want to make. System costs for design and construction and operation. And the design costs for these systems, it's a little hard to know exactly, but I, in looking at some history, it's probably a $5,000 to $20,000 design cost to design a system. Just depends on a number of factors. Construction costs, and this is where a lot of people are curious about this, it's between $1 and $2 per square foot for that building, a building, you know, 100 to 200,000 square foot building. On one hand, it's a lot of money. On the other hand, it's a small incremental cost for some structures. And it actually, in our experience, is turning out to be cheaper to do the active system than the passive system. We happen to be working, luckily, on this nice project called Northern Stacks, and we have 7 buildings we're installing. We're on our 3rd building and 4th soon to start. And so we're gaining a lot of experience with that. The operation costs are anywhere from zero for those passive systems. There's typically no moving parts, nothing really to be done from an operational standpoint, to an active system where it's maybe about $100 a month for electrical costs. It depends on the fan, it depends on the size of the building. So, again, and that's assuming you're operating that building or operating that system continuously, which also may not really be necessary and is a discussion we probably should have. So results, vacuums, you know, on subslab depressurization systems, we talk a lot about having 3 to 5 pascals of pressure differential depending on the season. And we're, depending on the system, these subslab ventilation systems, we're getting anywhere from essentially zero right at the and near to the fresh air inlet header pipe, I call it, to, in an active system, thousands of pascals at the point where we're drawing the air into that into the pipe that's being then discharged. Airflow rates, we're probably somewhere in the range of 100 to 200 CFM for the whole building, which means we're evacuating that space under the floor every half day to a day, something like that. And again, is that sufficient or is that even way overkill? Mass removal rates, real quickly, this is the system I showed you with the active fan. It's a combination subslab ventilation and an SVE system. And we started subslab vapor concentrations in the 5,000-6,000 micrograms per cubic meter range. We started the system up, and in a matter of months, we're down with a TCE, which is the main VOC, concentrations of like 80 micrograms, I believe. So it's working well. We've now turned the system off, and we're going to wait a couple months and see what happens if we get much of a rebound in those subslab vapors or in our extracted concentrations. And again, this is in the actual discharge of this system. Just a few thoughts I had. The system design, it really gets to concentrations, pathways, receptors, and really kind of almost more of a gut feel on, hey, is a vapor barrier membrane going to be sufficient? Or should we need? Do we need a fully active system 100% of the time operating? Again, a lot of information goes into something like that, and it's a very complicated solution if you start looking at it. An SV system can be either active or passive and work well. Our passive systems do work well. They are extracting vapors, and we can show that. These systems, I will say, always require that membrane to work correctly. And the membrane is also a little bit of a belt and suspender part of the system, just further along a risk management spectrum of lowering risks. The last thing I'll tell you is oversight of the system construction is absolutely crucial. Over all these years, we've seen where contractors, if we let them do their thing, sorry, Scott, wherever you are, if we let them do their thing, it won't get built right. And we've had to go back in and repair systems if we're not there providing some oversight. And so questions after the other two. So how do we do on time? Yes.
All right, so at the last session and this one, we have heard a lot about sampling techniques, building types that breathe differently, how to do pressure field extension monitoring, different mitigation strategies. Chris just had a lot of details on the actual mitigation. My favorite thing we had was a sweet regulatory citation pose down between Gary Krueger and Rick Kubler. That was nice. But the question that we haven't really touched on is, how likely is it that these things are going to happen at your site? In other words, what are the odds that you're going to have to do all these things? Well, what I'm going to talk about today is to help fill that picture in. First, I'm going to summarize a brief and relevant history of vapors. I think the things that have happened in the last 25 years here have really have a significant impact on the decisions you're going to make today. Secondly, I'm going to discuss a petroleum project that we're doing for the MPCA. In the program, it says two sites. I think the reality is it'll be a couple hundred. When you look at that many sites, it really allows you to make some general conclusions about how likely things are to happen. And then finally, I'm going to combine that history and the results to provide some perspective of what you'll face in the future. So the start of the historical info, and trust me, I'll be brief. There's more than 17,000 closed petroleum sites here. The MPCA's vapor assessment program really got going in around 2008. In my opinion, Tom Higgins did just an incredible job of leading that and getting it going when we had nothing. Before that program existed, most of those sites were already closed. I can look around the room and see 10 people that were probably associated with closing a couple thousand sites back then. And it's really important to understand how many sites were closed before we even started talking about vapors. And then, you know, came the due diligence guidance. ASTM E1527-13 said a phase one had to look at vapors. And then so many people had so many questions, they issued a clarification about how to analyze for a vapor encroachment condition. And, you know, you can use professional judgment, but let's be clear here. The original guidance says if you have a petroleum site within 0.1 miles, you have a condition. And this is why I'm up here talking about petroleum. I think solvents are a lot sexier. There's a lot more things going on when you have a solvent site. But let's be clear here. The conclusion is phase ones are going to identify a lot of petroleum sites. Those sites are located at all the key intersections throughout the state of Minnesota. They're usually the most desirable commercial property. Not only are there the 17,000 closed sites, there's also active sites everywhere. So the phase ones are going to continue to say, yeah, there's a petroleum site near your site, or it is your site. What else is going on here? The guidance makes it very clear that during a file review, you're supposed to look at closed sites with today's eyes. In other words, to be clear, you don't just evaluate a site and how it was closed. Instead, you look at it under those conditions using today's vapor rules, what decision would be made. That's what a phase one is supposed to do. So if you combine the new vapor rules from the MPCA and the new ASTM standard, there's really only one question you should ask. What about the closed sites? In 2008, when the MPCA rolled out the vapor assessment program, we were worried about the details of that program, but everyone kept asking, what about the closed sites? In 2013, there were seminars like this about the ASTM standard, and all everyone kept asking is, what about the closed sites? And to do a little check, how many people in this room, please raise your hand, either asked about closed sites, were asked about closed sites, or sat there the whole time thinking about closed sites? You know, I mean, this is the way it was. And the MPCA was pretty consistent on their answer. They said, we'll get there. Well, they got there. They've hired Bay West to begin looking at all the closed sites in Minnesota. Someone at the MPCA is screening them and trying to give us what they deem as the highest risk closed sites, sites with LNAPL, sites that are schools, sites that they've built a residential development over the top of. I'm sure it's not an easy screening process, but it's a start. And then they've given us instructions that are very clear. Look at these sites with today's eyes. If that sounds familiar, it should. In my opinion, it's exactly the same instructions that the ASTM guidance requires. So we're going through and basically conducting mini phase ones on every single closed petroleum site that we're given by the MPCA. And to date, we've looked at 249 files. We're scanning them in continually and looking at more. During our file reviews, it's kind of funny. One of our staff commented on how many sites in Hennepin County that Mary Sands and I signed the closure reports on. And I think what's really funny is she thought that was a compliment, but if you look at the next slide, maybe not. To date, we've looked at 249 files. We've recommended some vapor work at 223 of them. If you add, and to tell you the truth, this is actually a pretty conservative number because let's look at the 26 sites we didn't recommend work at. They were either a clean excavation where all contamination was removed, or there's no receptor at that site. But if you're doing a phase one, no receptor isn't exactly a reason, especially if you're going to come along and develop the site. So I think this percentage is actually low. What's the conclusion you can draw? 90 to 95% of phase ones with the petroleum site involved will probably have some kind of recognized environmental condition or vapor encroachment condition. 90 to 95%. I'd say a solvent site, it's probably higher than this. So, don't be surprised when this occurs. It's not surprising that when you have vapor intrusions forum, 250 people want to show up. This is what you're experiencing. So now let's talk about the phase two. I had to call Paul Weiss over at Terracon. Terracon is doing the phase two. The numbers aren't as high just purely because we've been doing our review work for about a year, and you know, because of access and stuff, it takes a while to get going. So they've drilled 69 sites so far. I suspected the answer before I called them. I said, Paul, how many actually required additional work after you drilled them? He said, seven. And I said, and I said, has that been pretty consistent? He said, yeah, 10%. It's been that way since we started this project. So at that pace, approximately 22 of the 249 sites we looked at are going to require either additional sampling or mitigation. Why is that? Well, with petroleum, I'd say aerobic degradation is probably the biggie. Those sites are getting cleaner over time, and if the vapors are exposed to a couple feet of clean soil, they'll likely diminish beneath the standard that requires stuff. Solvents don't quite do that as much. So conclusion number three, I think this is a pretty safe number when you're looking at the numbers we're reviewing. Only 10% of the phase twos with petroleum are gonna need more. I'm not saying you might not choose to do more, but only 10% are gonna be required to do more. And I mean, I think this might be a little surprising to some of you, but it's a very important fact. So, now let's dig into the seven sites out of the, you know, as this funnel continues to shrink down, why do these seven require additional work? The details on them are incredibly consistent. If you remember, during the last forum a month ago, Chris McLean said, well, it's the sites with LNAPL, it's the sites that the receptor is directly in contact with contaminated soil, and it's sites with very shallow groundwater. Chris is right on the money. I mean, this is what these facts show. All seven of those have one of those three conditions. In my 26-year career, I've worked on a lot of petroleum sites. Very few had a vapor problem. They all have. If they did, it's because of those three things. You know, what's funny is I asked Paul, could you have picked out those seven before we even started this site? Paul said, oh yeah. And I said, yeah, I agree. The conclusion is predicting these sites isn't all that hard. If you're gonna build it on a site that has shallow contaminated groundwater and there was LNAPL there, you're probably gonna have a vapor situation. Of course, you still have to do the due diligence steps to protect yourself, but being able to guess when it's going to be a problem is not that difficult. So, looking at these results a little further, we basically did 223 phase ones with petroleum that concluded some kind of vapor condition existed. Only 22 of the phase twos with petroleum are going to end up needing more work, requiring more work by the state's current standards. The question I want to pose, and let's talk about, is what about the other 200 sites? To clarify, these are sites that most likely have some petroleum vapor detections, but that the concentrations do not exceed regulatory thresholds that are going to be currently deemed a risk. During the last session, Gil, you had a couple questions about this exact type of site. And what I want to point out is that Gil wasn't bringing up some rare, obscure site that barely comes up. Gil's site is the norm. It's the other sites that are the rare exception, where the regulatory path is clearly defined, and it's pretty obvious. You either need vapor mitigation and you follow all these detailed procedures that people are presenting, or you don't even have to do anything. But most of the 200 fall into a gray area in between. Our numbers say 80%. So now, up until this point, what I've been talking about are all the facts. Once you start going into the gray area, you leave very factual conversation and have to go into opinions. And when you're in opinion land, it's harder to get people to really commit up here to tell you how things should be. The smartest thing I heard at the last month's forum, somebody asked a very detailed question about what do I have to do for in this such and such situation. Hans, I don't know if it was you or Gary who said, well, it depends on what letter you want. that advice should be thought of much more than it's being talked about. It does depend on what letter you want. It depends what your risk tolerances are. It depends on what liability protection you deserve. Because everything in the gray area is less about following requirements and a lot more about making well-informed decisions. I can't say it depends enough. When someone puts Grape on the spot and asks him a detailed question, some of the reasons he can't give a clear answer are that, well, it depends. I mean, it depends on a lot of stuff. So a nice way to highlight it is, Gil, you said Hennepin County funds vapor mitigation, whether it exceeds the state standard or not. What I think's very strong about that is they have had these discussions, thought through what should happen next. Deed has said we're going to fund vapor mitigation only when the state requires it. On one hand, you could think, wow, those are really opposite viewpoints. But I don't. They're just different risk tolerance stances that both make sense for people making those decisions. Again, here I'm really leaving the plan and getting into opinions, but I think these opinions are incredibly important, that how you talk about risk tolerance to make those decisions becomes everything, because 80% of our sites fall into the gray area where it's not obvious that you have to do what Chris just presented. Instead, it might make a lot of sense, it might not. It's something to discuss. I think it really captures why Chris is talking about passive mitigation when the MPCA said, well, we're not going to issue a letter on passive mitigation. That doesn't mean it's not a good idea that might do all kinds of liability protection for you. It just means you're not going to get a letter from a voluntary program. So I guess the real lesson is to be prepared for the most likely alternative. The most likely alternative that you will encounter at sites is that you're gonna detect stuff at concentrations less than requires mitigation. I thought it was great. I see there's some new BMPs that are gonna be presented today that I feel are in more detail exploring this exact issue. Chris used the term preemptive mitigation, but the concept is what happens when you mitigate when you don't have to. The rules aren't exactly the same then, you know, because your situation is different, but I don't know enough of the details what they're going to present. I'll leave that for them. But the concept is very strong. So my conclusion number six here is that team communication is key. You really need to have some very clear communication on risk tolerance, on what might happen in the future. You know, a conservative stance would be, do you think the Department of Health is going to increase or decrease health standards in the future? Most people would probably think that they're going to only decrease. You know, they don't exactly raise them a lot. On the other hand, petroleum is cleaning itself up while it's in the ground. And the MPCA has already gotten a little more liberal with some of these decisions compared to a year or two ago. We went from 10 times up to 33 times. I think that jives with what Tom Higgins explained when the vapor program started. I remember him telling me we're going to start conservative until we have enough data that proves otherwise. Well, now as they get more data, it does seem to be going in a slightly different direction. Are either of these right or wrong? Of course not. They're just things to talk about. So to kind of summarize what we learned from our reviewing hundreds of sites, 90 to 95% of the phase ones with petroleum are going to have some kind of wreck or vapor encroachment condition. And if it's solvents, it's even higher. Only 10% of the phase twos with petroleum are likely to need more work. That number is higher with solvents, but it's not as high as you probably suspect. Amanda Mullaney is working on a lot of assessment sites right now. She already told me we're putting in less mitigation this year than we were last year. Mary, is that what you're kind of experiencing already? Mixed, yeah. It is mixed. That's why it's not 10% with solvents. But it isn't 70%. You know, it's most of the sites are going to fall into the gray area. Predicting the sites that aren't in the gray area is relatively straightforward if the groundwater is shallow, if the LNAPL body is directly beneath your receptor, or your receptor is in direct contact with contaminated soil. And kind of my last message is communication about risk tolerance is critical. All the players involved in these sites need to understand that these are decisions they're making, not requirements they are forced to meet on most of the sites.
Good morning, Aaron Banker with Wink Associates. I'm presenting today on some case studies related to active vapor mitigation. Two sites, one of them is a classic brownfield site going into redevelopment, a larger industrial building that's being reused as a charter school. The other a little bit smaller, not in the brownfield program, but still a conversion into charter school. The active mitigation for these buildings has really kind of come to a head for both PRPs and brownfield developers who are looking to take old properties, not demo the building, keep the building, renovate, and creatively reuse them in many cases. There's a lot of sites as well that just through the transactional phase of property that are requiring some form of vapor assessment that are finding issues. And these are primarily in the chlorinated solvents. As Donovan just said, the petroleum doesn't seem to drive as much for vapor mitigation. I have one case example that's a really interesting reuse, and you'll see some photos of interior petroleum use where the vapors from petroleum actually don't trigger any type of reuse. But as you can imagine, a gasoline dispenser in the middle of a room that's going to be a charter school raises some concerns about what's really under the building in a long-term use. So fortunately, the chlorinated solvents do drive it and create a site that is suitable for mitigation. So I'm using three different sites. Two of them are case examples. One of them I'm using to just kind of go over the pilot testing and design considerations. In the last presentation, Eric did a good job on overviewing pilots. I don't want to belabor pilot testing too much, but I have some examples of what pilot testing shows from pressure field extension and how we do our pilot testing that really helps us lay out the design. Every building is unique. Every building requires site-specific pilot testing and design. You're trying to fish in depressurization pumps or trenches in buildings that have other uses going on. We don't have the luxury of new construction. You know, like Chris's example, you have a wide open building, you can lay your pipes, put the concrete over the top. In these situations, you know, you can use this room as an example. How would you mitigate a building like this? There's no interior columns, there's not very good connection. So that pilot testing is really answering a lot of those questions. The two case studies, there is some interesting on one of them, the pre and the post mitigation sampling, and then at the end a little bit of overview on future considerations related to O&M. So the pilot testing, the purpose of pilot testing really is, you know, evaluation of conceptual design criteria. You know, you've been in the building, you know essentially where your source areas or where your vapor concentration exists from the phase two. But one of the real important pieces that start to come together is to start to get an understanding of the building itself. And often some of these buildings were built in the 20s or the 50s with additions, and you'll see, if you look at aerial photos, you see all these little patchwork of rooftops that have all been put together. And you really have to have a real curiosity for how the building works and functions. And that curiosity really has to come out in the pilot testing. You're not only looking at airflow and pressure field evaluation, you're looking at utilities, you're looking at how is that building going to respond. Our goal generally with active depressurization is a 5 Pascal negative pressure field. And I don't know how many have tried to get 5 Pascals across 30,000 square feet or 50,000 square feet. It can be a little bit nerve-wracking when you're trying to sit back and design, and the pilot testing really helps to answer that in a way that allows assurance when you go and build the system. The classic sense as well is subset depressurization radius of influence testing. You know, how far will vacuum, you know, if you imagine the radon fan, how far does that single point extend? Every building is different. Lots of issues that come into play. The bottom bullet there, soil moisture evaluation. It's one of the biggest limiting factors in pilot testing results that can come into play. We often get buildings that are very, very wet beneath the slab, show very poor radius of influence. But you have to keep in mind that these active systems are fantastic at pulling soil moisture out. And so if you have a wet basement, put a radon fan in, you'll get rid of a lot of that moisture. It pulls out gallons and gallons a day. So your pilot testing data may show fairly poor radius of influence, but after weeks and months of operation, those pathways actually can improve. So evaluation of that on the pilot testing is very important, and an understanding of that. This really drives to what's the most efficient and practical layout for a subslab depressurization. Where can we get radius of influence, and where can we put our depressurization points? Like I said, every building is unique, and every building requires a building-specific design and pilot test. The bottom point, future construction must remain flexible. I think to Chris's point, you really have to, you can't, even after the pilot test, even after the design, you can't turn it over to a contractor to just go build it. They're going to run into issues. They're going to run into things that don't perform quite the way it was expected in a in-situ building that's being depressurized. So the construction, you have to go into it with some ability to remain flexible, Additional depressurization points may have to come in, changes in some construction techniques, and in fact, sometimes even cost. In my second project example, I'll go over some of those considerations. This is a typical overview of pilot testing at a building. This was just a section of the building. The overall building was about 50,000 square feet. But one of the there's two things that are going on in this building. The pilot testing showed relatively poor communication in portions of the building, and we were doing depressurization points, two of them at a time, and so we like to run our fans where we can look at the cumulative effect of what systems are. We're never operating typically with just one depressurization point, so we like to look at, can we pilot two of them at a time and find the net impact of running two systems. And what you'll see is in this portion of the building, running D, these two locations actually resulted in a pressure field of 3, where independently we were barely above 1. So being able to look at that and really spend a lot of time on the pilot test and look at it helps you understand the building and what your final system is gonna need to be. The other highlight of this is how it goes from pilot to design. We had very poor communication in this section, in this piece of the building. We had very good communication in this piece of the building. It allowed us to design those two spaces completely different to allow for a more efficient build. This next slide kind of shows side by side the pilot test results and the design. And the design is fairly straightforward. Where we had really poor communication, in these two portions, we utilized a trench. And a trench came out and put in a collection pipe the length of the building. Where we had good communication from the pilot test, we were able to just use sumps, basically what you typically see with a radon pipe going into the ground and that going up to the header. Much more cost effective to utilize sumps than trenches. But the trenches were necessary because we had very poor communication in those other areas. So those are the big pieces in going from pilot to design to really be thinking in the field, how is this going to work when you actually come in and build it? Those are the major pieces. So the first case study is a former industrial manufacturing facility, 20,000 square feet. This was a quick turn project. We were retained 45 days before the building was scheduled to open as a charter school. So we had to come in and have assurance that what we did would work. And so the first thing that I wanted to do, the site had a lot of PCE use in the past. I wanted to be sure that we knew we had a very high subslab concentration. But I wanted to be sure that if we apply depressurization to the building, that there's not other residual in the building that's going to affect our indoor air, because we knew we had to get clean indoor air to do it. So we utilized some real-time compound-specific air monitoring in the building to look at, is PCE source areas in the concrete in the building going to create a persistent problem that mitigation won't fix? Mitigation can only take care of what's in the subgrade. It may not take care of what's already in the building. So we utilized that, and it gave us enough data to see that the building did have indoor air issues, but they were relatively consistent throughout the building, and they were consistent with what we could model out of the subslab. Within 30 days, the building was under depressurization, and confirmation testing and performance evaluations were underway, and the school did open on time. These are just some overviews of the data before, and as you can see, the PCE numbers in subslab were up to 70,000, widespread across the site. It wasn't necessarily source area, and the indoor airs ranged in the 40s. One interesting piece that comes into play and is that we also had ambient air. We knew that ambient air was not related to the site. There was area-wide issues. Very important to understand that as well before you step into your mitigation, because the ambient air, there's not much you can do about, and it can become a real challenge to explain to the end user that their building has been mitigated, but yet there's persisting indoor issues related to ambient air. So an overview of the building, a fairly old industrial building. What I have highlighted in yellow boxes are the sumps that were pilot tested and ultimately became the final system, as well as a trench in the portion of the building. Again, the sumps were all designed based on pilot test. Our pilot testing showed great radius of influence right along the east side from just one. And so we were able to get three sumps and a trench. The trench is independent from the east and the west side with some clay barrier in between to prevent airflow so that we can control both sides of the building. Typical cross section for what the trench and the sumps look like. For buildings, a lot of buildings, industrial buildings, the rooftop blower is a preferred method up away from the population. Gets the air stack has to be above the roof line as well. But as you'll notice, every run itself off of a header will be valved. And when you build a system, you have to control airflow. You can lose a lot of air in a really a void space under the building. You have to be able to dial that back. You have to be able to apply higher pressure to some of your tighter and low flow, low permeable areas of the building. So each of these systems goes through a main header into a blower, but then they are valved. The trenches, there's a cross section in the next figure that shows, it's a P rock, typically about a 3/4 to a 1-inch river rock with a radially drilled PVC pipe. And we look at, kind of the total air demand for the building and how much we're trying to move and the radius of influence we're really trying to achieve with those trenches to get the spacing and the sizing of those holes. But ultimately, the P-Rock trench gets to an area of a level of equilibrium that applies a fairly even pressure across the length of the trench. Couple of photos, this is, very similar to installation of utilities in existing buildings. Saw cutting, trenches, removal of concrete, removal of soil, and then of course, placement of pipes. And you'll see this is the trench where these are solid pipes running back to the wall. There's the next photo that'll show the valving for that and perforated pipes that get laid down and then they get backfilled with P-rock and concrete. So patching and valving along the wall. The valving all runs up to the header pipes that go up into the rooftop unit. This is a overview of the sump. And the sump on this building had columns throughout the building. And so we had to get off the footing a little bit. But the footing does provide a pretty good void space around and gave us good airflow. We didn't want to disturb the footing, so the concrete is fairly shallow around the piping. And that, again, goes up to a riser pipe. So this shows our final system pressure field. We knew going in that we would, after the pilot test, what we would be able to get. So one of the things that is always difficult is what size fan do you put on the building when it's done? And you really can never project that until you're done. And what I found the best thing to be able to do is start your system up and run a temporary blower. And from that, what you want to do is dial that back to get as small a fan for the most efficient, long-term, cost-effective operation. And so we did that. We ran the temporary fan on this system primarily because of the quick turn that we had to do on it, but it allowed us to really dial in on the final fan sizing. There's really not a great way to project and get your airflow, perfectly balanced so that you get, your minimum pressure field being 5 and, you hit 5.1 at the corner. That can only be done by adjusting your valving down and then measuring how much you take out of that larger fan that you may be piloting with. We ultimately ran about a 230 CFM blower on this at about 18 inches of water column. And we had great pressure field across the building. After 7 days of operation, we were going back in to do sampling. And after that 7 days of operation, our subslab reduced below 4,000 from the high of 70. And our indoor air dropped below the residential ISVs. We still saw, of course, a little bit of residual from the ambient air that was out there. The last case study is a 68,000 square foot slab on grade building. Used to be used for distribution, and so they had a lot of truck traffic that came in and out of the building. They had two trench drains that ran the length of the building. That's over 400 feet each. It played into our design of the active system. And then there was interior USTs, fuel oils, gasoline, used oil. But primarily, as I said earlier, that site was driven by PCE and TCE. This is the interior of the building, long high bay building. As you can see, you know, this dispenser was here. This saw cut is where the gasoline lines run back to the fuel oil tank. And as you can imagine, you know, little Johnny's going to be sitting there someday as part of a school. So even though petroleum isn't driving this, a site like that would be very difficult to not do some form of mitigation on a building that's going to that use with that history, tanks beneath the slab. This is the trench drain. And the trench drain is also adjoined by a 400-foot tunnel system that runs the length of the building. Dumbest thing I ever saw. They dump water right into this tunnel and then they pump it out. And I'm not sure why they ever got that much water in there, but they have a lot. So all of that has to play into the overall design. We don't want air leakage into there. But the tunnel played into how we placed our pipes and how we utilized it to help cut down on our overall design cost. This is an overview of the design and some of the building highlights. It's a little bit busy, but this shows where the gas tanks were, the dispenser, the 400-foot trench ran both sides, and then there's actually a portion of this building that was being demoed, which brought us down to a new construction style installation of our system. The original design that I did included multiple runs because we want to valve, which our perforated pipes are, we want valving for each perforated pipe so that we can independently control each of those valves. So the original was to keep the floor clean and run individual manifolded pipe runs. We got the initial contractor cost back and it was a little over budget. So we changed the design, we went to a header system, and instead of valving back at a manifold, we did valving at each location, and there's a small sewer cleanout pipe that allows us access to get back in. And that was, you know, kind of a late minute redesign, but the system ultimately will operate a little bit more efficiently off of a 6-inch header feeding each of those. So, you know, the construction on this system is very much the same. It follows a trench layout, perforated pipes, saw cuts. But what we ended up doing is use the trench, which the workers are in right there, to lay our header pipe. And so that trench gave us a perfect location. It cut down on all of our concrete sawing. We didn't have to saw that. We could place this right in the trench. We could just saw the lateral perforated pipes off of that. The valve and the concrete, the interesting thing about this site is the way those trench drains work, the whole floor slopes towards the middle of the building. Doesn't work for gymnasium, doesn't work for school, so all of this entire floor will be covered with a new slab to level out the floor. So these are relatively temporary. They're just there to keep air from moving up into a little bit of a sand cushion that's being placed there. This is the selective demo area. This will allow us, and you can see all the challenges of these buildings in the airspace. There's lots of air voids. Those are generally good things for depressurization, but there are reasons why each of the systems, each of the collection pipes have to be valved. We would lose considerable air in a void space like that. And that will be filled up a little bit, but it won't be consistent. So we can valve that portion of the building back and not lose all of our air. When the system and the floor gets poured, the same thing will be going on for final fan selection. We'll be bringing in temporary blowers, hooking them up, probably letting them run for at least a day or two, and then go and valve down and make sure we have our pressure field, and then look at our total air demand before we purchased and installed the fans. So just a couple of considerations on the O&M. Almost all of the existing building mitigation work is tailored around and has kind of grown out of the residential radon industry, and the MPCA has created BMPs related to residential homes. That's driving the Pascal demand for air. I think, though, commercial buildings need a little bit different look at how we ultimately operate and build these systems. You know, to Chris's point, there's other ways to be effective, and the goal of vapor mitigation is to mitigate vapors. So the numeric standards give us some guides to work on, but they can certainly look at other ways so that we're not putting in too much into either air, energy to move that air, and long-term operation costs. You know, the sustainable long-term, I think, is a brownfield. We're constantly looking at ways to make sure that our designs are sustainable, that our operation, what we're giving our clients that are going to own these buildings and have, you know, conditions that will require them to operate fans for, you know, 15, 20 years or more, need to be as efficient as possible. And in that, I think that the bottom point, just to kind of jump down, is I think the real question to be asked on vapor mitigation when you're looking at an active system is, what is the mass flux? After 3 months, after, you know, 6 months, maybe after 2 years, most of those fans are going to be pulling relatively clean air. And is it necessary to continually operate 24/7 to pull clean air, or can we look at and utilize mass flux analysis? How quickly does it start to rebound into the subslab, and look at pulsing of the system, look at temporary operation? When you operate a fan, you know, that is, you know, 3 horsepower or 5 horsepower, you know, you can start to get into the $400 and the $500 a month in energy cost. If you really only need to operate that fan for, you know, 4 hours out of the day, you can considerably change the operational cost of the system by utilizing that. It's a difficult thing, because there's a lot of cost involved in some of the monitoring that can go along with it. But I think over time, we will generate a lot more data post-mitigation that'll allow us to move in a little bit in that manner to not just turn them on and leave them. You know, good operation and cut down on the cost. That's it. Yeah, I've looked at a couple sites that have had that exact condition, and you know, I think that the trench installation for a commercial building also allows some opportunity to collect water. When you're digging these trenches, you can look at installation of a water collection pipe beneath your depressurization system, or utilize that. You know, the goal, if you have enough historical information to know that the building floor has never gone submerged, it may not be as important to manage the water from an owner and a flooding standpoint. And then what you'd have to look at is, what's the soil type? And do you have an ability to dry that out by continual operation of air beneath the slab? You will dry it out, but it would depend on how, you know, really how saturated is that, and is it silt, sands, clays? But I would first look at, is that building a good candidate to install some sort of collection of water? And I know that's a challenge, because most of these sites were mitigating because there's contamination. No one wants to manage contaminated water as a byproduct. But if I'm the owner and my building is flooding, well, I guess you're going to have to manage water regardless.
See, I would just say that the vacuum that you're creating in using, Aaron, your example, I think you said it, you had a fan with 18 inches of water vacuum. If that 18 inches is applied right below the floor, you're going to draw that water up from a groundwater table 18 inches. So you just have to do the math, and you'll know that you'll have a problem or not, generally.
I have a question for Aaron. What instrument do you use for your real-time PtC monitoring, and what's the accuracy?
We used a Frog 4000. So we've had relatively good results using the Frog. You know, that does get down to a part per billion, roughly, of TCE, PCE. The group that we supplies it to us, they'll calibrate it before down to a microgram. So it's pretty good. We've seen some drift, but they've been very good at helping recalibrate in the field. If you swamp a machine, you'll have some time to let that clean itself out. You may have to run four or five samples. But it is a very good piece of equipment. I've used it on some other forensic indoor air evaluations where we've had indoor sources that we've looked for as well. So it's a very useful piece of equipment. It's, when I compared it to the lab data, it's, you know, it's similar to the PID to lab data. You have to kind of use it as a rule of thumb, but you will get some at least compound specific data that's pretty usable.
Talk to us about your experience with barometric pressure changes or changes in water table fluctuations in buildings in alluvial areas. It's not uncommon to have a 3 or 5 foot bounce in the water during the years. And speaking to your pulse an assessment of that.
I think just one clarifying point to the inches of water column that's being measured is at the fan, is at the head pipe. We're distributing that air fairly evenly so that we're not seeing 18 inches of water column within the trench. So we're not drawing, we don't have enough air pressure to, you know, draw the water up. But that's distributed over 20,000 or 30,000 square feet. So we don't really see any effect on the natural water table from our systems. It's very similar to SVE. You might see some radial where you have that really concentrated vacuum that sometimes can go into it. You may raise that water table, but for subslab depressurization, that's not the case. Well, the theory behind pulsing is to have dropped your subslab concentrations and demonstrate that over a 18-hour period of a day, those concentrations will remain well below any intrusion levels to counter when the barometric pressure change. So if there's no vapors in the subslab, the barometric pressure won't drive contaminants back into the building. That's the point. We've essentially evacuated the vapors for a period of time. They will rebound, and there's a depth at which they still will be not affected by the SVE or the subslab depressurization. So what is that distance, and what is that travel time, and what's the ability to project that and operate within that drawdown of the TCE, the mass flux of it?
Person on the other side, you want to just speak loudly?
Zero. So just some clarification on that. But I'm serious, zero. A contaminated site, industrial site. We did a fairly significant remedial investigation, including vapors. We did a big soil correction, moved a lot of soils around, keeping soils on site for the most part. Constructed buildings with these vapor mitigation systems inherent to the building construction. So we're not going through the floor, our client's nice brand new floor, to check for subslab vapors after the fact. So if it had been an existing building under the new guidance, then that would be a different story. I've been looking at some existing buildings and having to follow the existing guidance. A 200,000 square foot building, I think, ends up being 44 paired samples over a twice a year. That's not, for most clients, that's not happening. They can't afford it. So that won't happen.
You know, I just wanted to throw in, though, that's where your desired letters come into play. Chris may be making a different request at the end of that situation.
I agree with Chris. I'm asking for the same letters. But, no, I think that there's maybe a little confusion on that. The guidance does put that out as a way to verify that a building is not affected by, that a completed pathway is not complete by collecting that level of sampling. So when you're looking at a site, like Chris said, you know, I think one of the kind of shames of vapor mitigation is that we're all working on buildings and we're working on property lines and we're often ignoring the overall conceptual site model and groundwater and soil and source location. And, you know, zero or one or five is enough if you know you have issues and you have verification. We do need some level of subslab if we're applying to grant programs and having a response action plan, but I think that's variable. To your question on how many pilot locations we do on buildings like that, I do not do a design or layout until I'm comfortable that I know what the entire building is, how it's going to respond. For the 20,000 square foot, that was about 8 pilot locations. On the larger ones, it's been, you know, a dozen or more. And it all depends on how, you know, if I could get a one location and see that the whole building, you know, had great flow, I'd be done. But that's rarely the case. You know, and the field crew get really annoyed when I keep asking for, you know, go core more, but it's you got to be comfortable.
So just for clarification, to get those association determinations or to get RAP approval, is the goal of the question that is possible. So Eric, you mentioned that you're able to subscribe between 0 and 5 samples to prove that it's working properly?
Oh, you're talking about on the verification side. The verification side, you know, I'm primarily relying on the pressure field. That's that, you know, again, we have another line of evidence. So again, I don't agree that the just standard table, 22 samples on 100,000 square foot building applies, because we have another line of evidence. That's the active and measured depressurization of the subslab. So to your question, that hasn't been fully answered. That the larger building, you know, I will tell you, I think the cost of sampling, if we were to follow the guidance, would be astronomical compared to even what the construction cost is. So I think it should be something much less than that. Not opposed to indoor air verification, but it's just the quantity of those on an active system, I think, needs to be taken into account.
Chris, I think I heard you mention that a membrane was critical to an SSD system. Are you talking about a vapor barrier membrane? And if so, can you elaborate a little bit on that?
I am talking about a vapor membrane, a barrier membrane, such as a Stego Wrap or Raven Industries membrane. And it's really one being, as I mentioned earlier, sort of just another line of protection from vapors entering the building above. Vapors aren't going to be absolutely perfect, but they're going to, even if I had no vacuum under there, no flow, the membrane's going to stop the majority of intrusion just by virtue of being there. It helps channel the flow, if you will, of the air that we are drawing. So we're creating a vacuum under that in an SSV system, really not any different than an SSD system. I think the main thing is bringing in that fresh air and creating that vent layer that may not be there in the case of Aaron's example, where you're left with whatever soils happen to be there. And as he saw, you know, they vary from one part of the building to the next. We're creating a common vent layer. And again, that membrane is helping sort of sandwich that layer in between our contaminated soils below and the building slab section above. Does that answer that question?
Can we have time for maybe one more question after this? Go ahead.
It's for Donovan. You talked about shallow groundwater. You've seen a lot of numbers now and looked at a lot of different sites. What's your depth that constitutes shallow groundwater?
Well, I think it's the same thing that everyone is saying. I mean, when you're within a couple feet of the slab, it depends on the fluctuation at that site. But in the petroleum world, shallow is definitely, you need a clean foot or two is really, I think what a lot of data shows will degrade the vapors. But just thinking within 5 feet of your bottom of your structure, I think would count as shallow. Enough that all the other moisture problems that people are bringing up come into play. It's the same problem, just looked at from a different angle.
Okay, we have time for maybe one more question. Thought I saw a hand up here. Charlie?
Well, hi, this is probably for Chris. You brought up the idea of HVAC systems, and I'm just wondering, what's the downside of using either an existing HVAC system or proposed in overpressurizing a building and avoiding all this subslab stuff completely?
So I've looked at doing that in the past. And I guess I would say the downside is, one, the additional energy it takes to additional cost to perhaps modify your HVAC system. In an industrial commercial building, sometimes those are very large systems. costing hundreds of thousands of dollars. Additional energy to run either a new or an additional fan, say, that's drawing air in, having to condition that air, and especially here in Minnesota, either air, you know, in the summer or the winter. There can be issues with increasing the pressure in the building on comfort for individuals working in the building. There can be influences on other operations in the building, such as, I don't know, certain equipment with pilot lights and sensitive equipment of one kind or another. So there's, it becomes a situation where you're not quite sure of all the outcomes, and therefore it becomes risky. It can be, though, an added line of defense to vapor mitigation. I guess I'm not aware of a building where that was the sole solution. It's very possible there is an example out there. So can I add one thing to my earlier response about the vapor barrier? And I don't know why I say this. Under the building code, if you're building a 100,000 square foot building, if you have conditioned space and you've got floor coverings, it's maybe a paint, it may be carpet like we see here, the building code does require a water vapor barrier, but it's a 6 mil poly with no requirements on installation and so forth. And I just want to point out, because it's come up recently for ourselves and I think a number of others, that is not a vapor intrusion vapor barrier under most people's definitions, and the cost of that is minimal. And there's a number of contractors here, I think, that would attest that that cost is not much. The construction oversight is minimal. So when we talk about a vapor barrier membrane, we're talking about something that's much more robust.
Using positive pressure, something we've done, you know, I think Chris summed up why it's a little trickier on an entire building, but it can really come into play in some of the unique features, you know, a utility tunnel between two buildings, and there are things you encounter where in those unique situations, the positive pressurization can be a really good solution, but I think you summed up why an entire building, it's a little tougher.
All right. Please join me in thanking Chris, Aaron, and Donovan. Okay, we're going to take a quick break, but three housekeeping items really quick. Pardon? Yes, if you could, please. Hello, this is Martha. Okay, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have even answered my phone, but I saw that it was MPCA. Okay, great. I will call you back. Thank you. Okay, bye-bye. All right, everybody. If you want to take your seats, we're ready to get started for the second half. And we can get started as soon as everybody's seated. Think so. Hey, Chris, could you ask Marcus and Dave to sign this, please? Here, it's a pen. Okay. All right. One tiny critique that Minnesota Brownfields has with this series is, maybe I'm the only one that's noticed, but there's been a severe gender imbalance in our panelists and speaker participation, and that's very obvious to me right now. So if there are women doing this work that want to be involved next time we do this session, because there will be a next time, please let us know. I had a really funny slide. Actually, I had a video clip. I can't make the technology my friend today. I wanted to show a slide of Kevin Costner in a cornfield in Iowa. If you're of a certain age, you know, and you like baseball movies, you know what I'm talking about, Field of Dreams. The kind of line that came out of that movie is, if you build it, they will come. I don't know why, last night, getting ready for this session, I was thinking, if you talk about vapor, they will come. So maybe that could have been the informal pitch for this session. I would like to thank all of the panelists that are up here with us now. Again, we're not going to read bios, but just to introduce them in order that they're seated, Hans Navy from MPCA and Chris McLean, also of MPCA, Marcus Martin with the Metropolitan Council, David Liverseed with M.A. Mortensen Company, Del Eric with Fagree Baker Daniels, and Jason Scramstad with Landmark Environmental. What we're going to do next is Hans is going to take a little more time to just do a channel surf on some selected topics related to the BMP development and stakeholder process, and then he'll take a seat. Steve Jansen from Braun is going to be our moderator for a Q&A session, and you all told us you wanted a little more time for that last time, so we restructured the remaining part of our time for what we hope will be a really robust audience discussion and stakeholder feedback. So, Hans, you are up.
Are under development, some we haven't even touched on yet, the operation and maintenance piece. So there's important inputs into the process. The technical research work being done by academics, in many cases funded by EPA, and the EPA guidance itself. It's very important to us that we are lined up and in step with EPA, mostly because of the pressures we're referring more projects to them. And so it's not good if there's a big gap between what they're doing and what we're doing. It's important to us to stay consistent there. Stakeholder input's very important in this process. There's no way to do it without getting that. I feel like we're getting more stakeholder input and making changes based on stakeholder input more than we ever have before, but we are looking to expand that. I'll talk a little bit about that. And then also site-specific experiences using the BMP. We want to have it be used and criticized and feedback sent our way so we can make it the adjustments that we're planning to make. So we're talking about and thinking about ways we can really expand stakeholder input. This is an important part of the process. Some ideas that we're thinking about are forming a advisory council made up of you all. Technical advisory council, policy advisory council, that's one way to do it. Another way is to, and we're serious about this, is having stakeholders embedded in the guidance development team. So you have a place at the table the same as our staff do, and you're fully involved in the process each step of the way. We're open to that. It comes with a significant time commitment and some other issues to work through, but it's something we're willing to talk about. Okay, so what I'm going to largely touch on today are some updates to the BMP we have in process. So what we have on our webpage is issued BMP. We also have some things that are in process, and I wanted to share with you what's in process. We have posters in the back. These are the same topics that the posters present. The things that are under, and this is the site-specific experience using the BMP, is really a driver for what issues are unresolved, where do we need to do our work now to fill the holes that are left in the things we've issued. So the things are partial building investigation, partial building mitigation, and preemptive mitigation. These are the things that we're working on right now. We've got draft documents that we're looking for stakeholder feedback on. This is where we are in the process. So I talked about this last time, and I want to just touch on it again. It is a really important piece. So there is the BMP. It's coming out in pieces. It's going to get adjusted through this development period, which will last several years. But behind the BMP are guiding principles. If you understand this, you'll be able to predict what we're going to do. Because if you ask us to do something, this is what we'll go back to. And we'll say, is it consistent with these guiding principles? One of the things you'll see there is mitigation effectiveness is confirmed by testing. That's an important guiding principle. Working on the preemptive mitigation, you know, I'm starting to we're all starting to sort of reveal that there's another building block that's needed. So we're starting the process of cutting a new building block. It's not cut yet. We have an idea of what it may look like. But this is sort of what it is. It has related to preemptive mitigation. And the building block that is starting to form, it's not formed yet. There's still plenty of time for people to influence it So this is what it is. Preemptive mitigation may resolve vapor intrusion risks in the short term, but doesn't really address the long term, and doesn't address the need to notify future property owners by itself. Okay, so we're saying preemptive mitigation is mitigating a building without enough data to make a mitigation decision. The issue usually looks like you've got one round of samples and deciding to mitigate the building, which is fine to do that. This is preemptive mitigation. Another form of this is mitigating a building when the data shows it's not needed. It's two different types of preemptive mitigation. So mitigating a building without enough data to make a mitigation decision. Because we don't know, and every time we approve something, we take on liability. We relieve you of some liability. We take it on ourselves. We're in a position of saying, if you're deciding to mitigate without the data to show it's not needed, we're sort of in a position where we have to assume it was needed. So we're going to ask for the post-mitigation verification testing, and we're going to ask for an institutional control. You can't do one. Doesn't work. We don't want to see the situation where there's one round of testing, a system's installed to get through the closing, and then the day after the closing, we're good, we can turn everything off. This is like the worst case end member. So we, but we think about these things. We do. Preemptive mitigation, mitigating a building when data shows it's not needed. It's not needed, this is something you're doing on your own. You can have zero confirmation samples for a system like that. It's not needed, and there's no IC. So a couple questions that are starting to come up. Here's one. When mitigation is needed, adjacent buildings are automatically included in the vapor intrusion area of concern. I talked about this last time. So to say we've fully defined the area, the issue is resolved. When a building's been mitigated, we're saying adjacent buildings are now of concern. Okay, we need to be able to say for sure adjacent buildings are covered. This is different when the building has been mitigated preemptively. Okay, so this is not an assumption we'll make now that all that automatically adjacent buildings are now of concern. Can I do the scenario that I just talked about? Can you take one round of sample, preemptively mitigate, and then install the system and proceed with the verification testing, but use the verification testing for the system, the sub-slab sampling, as your second round of samples to conclude the system's not working? So right now, or to conclude the system's not needed. So let me say that again. So you've got your first round, you need two seasonal samples to conclude a building does not need vapor intrusion mitigation. You have your first one, you've installed a mitigation system, you're proceeding with the confirmation testing, which includes subslab data. Say, oh, now I do have two rounds of subslab data, the one before and the one after the system was running. That's two, and we can make a decision on that. So we're saying that doesn't work for us. This is not really an apples and apples comparison. So you're still in a situation where we don't have enough data. You've preemptively mitigated without enough data to say the mitigation is not necessary. If you're detecting contaminants above the standard after the system is installed, certainly this is a system that's needed. Okay, partial building investigation. These are both just proposals. What we have in the posters in the back where I'm talking about now, these are proposals that we're working on, hoping to get stakeholder feedback on. We have a project, a state-funded project now. It's 20-some in commercial industrial buildings in a vapor intrusion area of concern, 500 samples to clear all the buildings. We don't have that kind of budget for this project. You know, I'm imagining many of you are running into the same issue. You know, many of these buildings are on the ring, on the edge of the vapor intrusion area of concern. Is it needed to, as the first step, test the entire building? Probably not. There's probably cases where it does make sense to only begin with part of a building, a commercial industrial building that's large. What we're saying is the first bite of that building should be 30,000 square feet. And we're concerned about preferential vapor pathways. And we're also not so interested in this if it's pretty clear the source is under the entire building. So partial building investigation leads you to partial building and mitigation, which is an extension of this. The vapor intrusion area of concern only covers part of the building. Sort of makes sense to consider only mitigating part of the building. So now I'll turn over to Chris McLean to talk about petroleum.
Thanks, Hans. Good morning. It's nice to see that the sun is actually starting to peek out. So I'd like to just talk about petroleum site. Basically what we're saying is just go ahead and do the LSI or the remedial investigation under our current policy, the way it's written right now. You guys have been doing this for the last decade plus, so that part doesn't change. You follow the current guidance as written. However, you will, once you've collected your data, your vapor data, you will be evaluating it using the 33 times and not the 10. So that's a slight modification there. But basically just continue to follow the guidance as written. However, once you've determined from your investigation and you've analyzed your vapor data that you do have a vapor area of concern, you will then need to jump over to the BMP and follow the BMP from that point on. So it's pretty straightforward, pretty simple. Stick with the guidance as is, do your evaluation, use the 33. Then if it looks like you're above that standard, you have a vapor area of concern, kick over to the BMP. So that's just wanted to highlight that and just reemphasize that. It sounded like people wanted to hear about it again from the last presentation. So one other issue that does tend to come up sometimes at when you're doing these investigations is that a lot of times you'll sometimes stumble across non-petroleum compounds. And so we've kind of developed an internal process for how we evaluate that information and pass it on and then, you know, contact applicants or RPs, how we're handling that. So we've assigned some specific staff in both site assessment and petroleum to work on this. This allows us to establish a certain level of consistency of information that's being transferred between the two programs. If we had all of our staff kind of working on this, we thought it might be a little inconsistent. So we just assigned a few specific staff to work on this part of it. So contamination is identified at a petroleum site, or non-petroleum contamination identified at a petroleum site. Our staff will then collect certain pieces of information from the investigation. They will assemble that information, and they will then transfer that over to the site assessment staff. Now, the time frames that'll occur are somewhat dependent on when we get the information. So the sooner we get it, obviously, the sooner we can make those determinations and transfers. But in general, once we've reviewed the information, that information will be transferred within approximately a week to the site assessment staff. Site assessment staff will then review the transferred information and make a prioritization of that site based on current workload, funding, you know, all those different aspects that will fall into their prioritization process. So if it happens to be a petroleum brownfield site that's being worked on, we will then advise them that they need to jump over to the non-petroleum part of the brownfield program, VIC, and get enrolled there, because, you know, if the applicant needs assurances or RAP approval, they'll need to be involved in both programs, not just the petroleum. So those are the couple of areas I just wanted to highlight on the petroleum side. So that's, I think that's where.
Hello, I'm Steve Jansen with Braun Intertech. I guess maybe just to wrap up Chris and Hans's presentation, do we want to take any initial questions right now? And maybe before we do that, I'll give you just a quick overview of what we were hoping to do with today's panel discussion. You know, in working with Mary Sands and Martha and Chris Thompson and I, and with input from MPCA over the last couple of months, as we've pulled this panel together today, we've, you know, it's somewhat of a continuation of our last vapor forum here a month ago. I think you'll see some overlap on the topics, which is inevitable here. But, you know, our hope is with today's panel is to get, we've allowed more time to have a kind of an interactive back and forth here regarding the topics that are on today's list. What we're thinking right now, I think we're going to start talking about kind of the basic mitigation process and what it's looking like now under the new BMPs. We're also going to talk a little bit about long-term mitigation obligations. We're going to talk about underground parking and vapor mitigation. Talk a little bit about the new preemptive mitigation that Hans just spoke about. And then also I had down maybe discussing merits of vapor barriers. I think as we discuss each of these topics, you know, the hope is we can get the consultant perspective, the MPCA perspective, the owner-developer perspective from Dave, the legal perspective on a few of these topics from Dell, and then a little input on potential grant questions that may come up. And I think as we tackle each one, you know, certainly we'd like the audience to jump right in. I think now that the vapor guidance has been out for on the assessment and mitigation end for about 4 months, it's still, in my opinion, very, very early in its infancy here. There's yet to be any projects that have been fully completed under it from the assessment stage through the mitigation stage. Right now, I think we're, as a Brownfields industry here, we're struggling a bit just that, you know, we've got projects in all different stages right now. We have ones that have already been mitigated under approved RAPs, and now we're coming to completion of construction, and we got to consider doing confirmation sampling. We've got, you know, new requirements that are starting to come out regarding institutional controls that maybe weren't contemplated a couple of years ago. And obviously there's new sampling requirements. So I think as a industry here, we're stuck being patient over the next year or two. Things are somewhat of a moving target, but I guess my opinion is we need to move together, you know, as a group. I think each person on this panel on any given Brownfield projects, we're all part of the success of the project. It's we really all have the same goal. It's to get these contaminated properties redeveloped and back, you know, back in play. And we're going to all have to work together. We all already do all on a daily basis. And that's, I guess, that's where we're at. And the MPCA is our friend, is how we have to look at it here. So with that said, any just quick questions for Hans or Chris on the topics that were just discussed? We are going to, I think, talk a little more in detail about the preemptive mitigation, but any general questions right now? Okay, that's scary. So with that being said, oh, did we have one? Ah, Imats.
The mitigation part, I think there is some room. You know, like it is, as you say, there's foundation. Sometimes it looks like one building on the surface. On the subsurface, it's actually sort of multiple buildings. So, yeah, there's some wiggle room for that. And, you know, this is just a proposal right now. So we're here today to get this kind of feedback you're offering. So thank you for your comment and question. Yeah, this is a conversation we've had internally. I think what you're telling me is what we've put out is could be more clear, could be more concise, could be an all in one place, and that would be helpful. I think that's true. And we're working on it. There are some significant constraints with our risk assessor does the calculations here. So it seems like it's something that could be done overnight. It turns out it's actually not that way. We've got SRVs and other site-specific demands going on right now.
Okay, well, with that, why don't we kind of jump into our first topic, which is just vapor intrusion mitigation process. I guess what it's looking like now with the new guidance out, and then we'll kind of open that up just to get some audience input. Jason, maybe you can start us off and just give us the 10,000 foot view, and then we'll tie that back to some of the actual MPCA requirements.
Sure, no problem. The mitigation process, I think, is still going to be largely based on the 2015 guidance that came out. It was for active vapor mitigation systems in single-family residential homes. And the process that outlines, it has several checklists that include a checklist for pre-diagnostic testing, system installation, post-mitigation diagnostic testing, and then analytical confirmation sampling. And a lot of those steps were discussed in Aaron Benker's presentation, and he basically went through all those. And the pre-mitigation testing, you install a suction pit, vapor monitoring ports, and you determine a pressure field extension, which that data is extrapolated and used to design your full-scale system, your fan size, your piping size, your number of suction pits, and that sort of thing. The post-mitigation testing is, once your system's installed, you need to verify that you've got the pressure field extension that meets the criteria outlined, the 3 to 5 pascals, depending on what season you're in. And the confirmation analytical sampling required is required 7 to 30 days after the system is started. Between that window, you got to get your first round of confirmation sampling. And if it's not in the winter season, you have to do another round in the heating season.
Okay, thanks. Hans, with this new guidance, we're all used to a lot more actions happening on our brownfield redevelopment sites. Vapor has always just been, you know, one of the number of things. I guess from what we've been seeing, to me, the guidance doesn't really alter the fact that we're going to want to have our mitigation design at least conceptually laid out in our response action plan for a typical VIC site that we're, you know, going for RAP approval on. As well as, you know, our RAPs, we're typically going to be laying out our confirmation testing at the end of the day, our you know, pre-mitigation diagnostic testing. Are there going to be any instances under this guidance on a brownfield site where a full-blown response action plan might not be needed, or do you guys still view that as a necessary step you know, to ultimately obtaining a completion of vapor response actions letter at the end of the day on a site?
I had a professor in college. We would joke behind his back, this guy, he wants us to provide specific answers to general questions. And I suppose that's the role of a good teacher, you to think in that way.
Personal opinion is all we're asking.
Yeah.
It's being recorded.
Yeah. I don't want to give the impression that there's more things are changing than are right now. The process you all go through to report to us and the titles you put on different reports, we're not changing that or proposing that gets changed at all. Things that are important to us with vapor are that we know where the vapor intrusion area of concern is. Sometimes that's resolved fully on the property. Sometimes it extends off the property. And now we have some work done by a voluntary party and other reporting done by us or a responsible party. It's important to us that we have documented for the buildings that get mitigated how they were mitigated and that there's a long-term plan. If you can do that in a wrap in the structure that is there now, that's a good thing because it means less change for the process we have. Did that answer your question?
I think that's a good start. We'll see if it comes up again here. Marcus, I know at the last session there were some discussions at that panel with Kristen Lukes on it regarding different types of vapor-related assessment and mitigation that is potentially grant eligible. I guess from, you know, what we've been seeing so far, in the past, the grant agencies are, you know, fully behind assessment costs as well as you know, mitigation costs. With some of these new requirements coming out, you know, specifically the post-construction confirmation sampling, you know, that is a relatively new animal, you know, for our industry here. In fact, I think there's very few sites where that data even exists yet, but we're heading into this new realm. How do you see that, say, from Met Council's standpoint?
Thank you for the question. Steve, I think for, I'm here really representing Metropolitan Council, but also some of the other local grant programs, so DEED and the county programs. And I think we're in some ways in the same place that you guys are. We kind of want to see how it plays out. But in general, we want to have good testing beforehand. We're willing to pay for that. We want to see those results. We want to implement, we want to pay for implementation as designed. We want to be sure that it works. So I think for us, that's been true before, and I think that'll still be true. So additional sampling at the end, we would look at that similar to how we look at paying for implementation reports and other types of contaminants. So we continue to do that.
I know Gil and Kristen are both here. Would either of you two like to add anything to that from your agency's perspectives? Not seeing Kristen out in the sea of the audience there. Oh, there, you're hiding over there. Okay, thank you. Good answer. Well, with that, I know this was kind of our first and a little more general and maybe not as contentious topic. Does anyone want to contribute something from the real life perspective of the audience here on this particular topic? Aaron?
To sample, and so that's really the limiting factor on a lot of grants' ability to pay that, correct?
That is one factor, yes. I think the aspect of what it is that you're asking, in this case sampling, post-completion sampling, and then when. I don't have a great sense of how long that would continue. Our typical grant terms are around 3 years, so we would want to be within those 3 years.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I view the best management practices within the context of voluntary redevelopment of brownfield sites. And so there is a broader context than just, you know, meeting the technical specifications of the BMPs. And where I'm seeing things becoming challenging for everybody is related to what Donovan mentioned, the it depends factor. That we're encountering voluntary sites where people want to redevelop the land and do what's necessary for that economic redevelopment and meet the environmental standards. But there's a great deal of ambiguity when it comes to working with the MPCA, where in these it depends situations, there's a lot more room for different opinions. And what I see people getting scared of is if they enter the voluntary program and have an honest disagreement with the MPCA about whether mitigation is necessary or if they feel that they need to just preemptively mitigate because it has to be factored into their costs. If the MPCA doesn't agree, then suddenly they're at risk of becoming superfunded and stigmatized, both the developer and the property, in perpetuity. And so I offer that as a comment. I think the question would be, how is the MPCA viewing that, and are you figuring out how to work around that conundrum?
Maybe that's, well, Dell, you want to chime in on that?
I'd like to hear thoughts first.
Okay, and then Dell will chime in.
Could you say more about what the disagreement looks like?
Be specific.
Yeah, be specific. Can you give me an example? It can be a hypothetical if you'd like.
Well, a developer needs to figure out their budget so they can get their financing, so they just assume that they're going to have to do mitigation. But the MPCA disagrees, and so they don't get RAP approval. So that's one type. Another type is where essentially the level of investigation provides a great deal of confidence of minimal risk of vapor intrusion to the indoor air. Yet, because there is some reservoir of vapors, the MPCA still requires mitigation. And there's just a disagreement as to what the real level of risk is there. And so if the developer chooses to say, well, we no longer want a no association determination for this issue, the MPCA can then say, well, okay, then we're going to put you in the state assessment program instead, and you're on the Superfund list.
Okay, there's a long way to go from state assessment program to Superfund list, and that's probably a good thing. The disagreement you're talking about, I hope we don't have too many of those where the data's been collected and we're disagreeing about the decision of whether or not mitigation's needed. That should be mostly clear. That's one of the goals of the BMP, that's a point of stability to provide. You could say, and this is actually what I'm here today to hear, is we think that framework is wrong. We think that framework is too conservative. It doesn't work for us. We think you should make these changes. I'm here today to hear exactly what those changes are. If that's the point of disagreement you're talking about, then I want to hear more about that, because the BMP is something that's going to change in the future. The site assessment referral, we're having more site assessment referrals now than we have before, and that is primarily because of vapor. You know, we're in a situation now where we have to know the extent of the vapor intrusion area of concern. So, you know, here's an example. If a property comes into the Brownfield program and there's clearly MRLA, there's clearly hazardous substance contamination there, and also petroleum, and the posture and the decision is we don't want to have anything to do with something other than the petroleum Brownfield program. Okay. That's a choice, but now we're put in a spot if we know there's likely a vapor intrusion area of concern. Let's say in this example there's a daycare nearby, okay, and now we've got a population that is by definition going to have more concern on several fronts. We can't just let that go. We need to do what is needed to find the vapor intrusion area of concern there, and we're left with limited options, and that one of the limited options is site assessment. So I hear what you're saying. It does seem like unfair. It seems like we're forcing this. It seems like we're throwing weight around. And I get that, but we have a need, too, that has to be fulfilled. And that's sort of where we are. My hope in all these situations is we can just talk about it and understand each other. I can say, this is what our needs are. This is why we're doing this. You can say, okay, this is what the needs of my client are. This is the decision we're making. There's almost always a way to solve it that works for everybody. There's almost always a landing place. And this is a conversation that we're really interested in having.
Dell, you want to chime in?
Sure. A couple of comments, but first a little context. It's nice to see everybody motivated by a Superfund issue. When I was in law school my first year in December of 1980, I had a professor come in right before exams with a big sheaf of paper, and he held it up. This is the comprehensive environmental Response, Compensation, and Liability Act. Right? And it looks to me like it imposes retroactive liability. If that's right, there are many of you in this room who are going to be dealing with this law for most, if not all, your careers. And in my case, he's right. Now, why do I say that? Because what I urge the agency to think about are these sorts of consequences and unintended consequences. When CERCLA was passed in 1980, it was clearly viewed that EPA would take the major role, and it would direct Superfund cleanups. And, you know, occasionally there might be volunteers who would then sue, perhaps, outside of the agency's presence and redistribute all these costs. Well, what happened? Well, you all know what happened. Folks like our developer clients, you know, when they were doing property transactions, suddenly said, well, whoa, wait, retroactive liability? And CERCLA had status liability. You become an owner, you've bought that problem. And so what happened in my personal practice, I spent a lot of time dealing with transactions. Roll this forward, right? MRLA gets passed. And here, I think this is important, and I urge the agency to think about this. MRLA does not have the same sort of status liability. If you buy a property, you typically have to do something else to associate yourself with the pre-existing contamination. That's the basis for the, you know, basically the Brownfields, the Minnesota Brownfield Recycling Act of, what, about 20 years ago, that admittedly has been extremely successful. Okay, and the whole notion of the no association letter was, well, you acquire property and you do it in such a way and you do a certain cleanup perhaps, and then you're not going to associate yourself with the existing contamination. That model works very well, I think, for contaminated soil. It works pretty well with groundwater. Thou shalt not use it as a drinking water source. Don't put foundations in the contaminated water if that's a problem. I'd submit it doesn't work particularly well with vapor. So think about your transaction, right? You've got a developer client who wants to acquire a brownfield site. Let's just say there is a TCE plume underneath that property. It's going to put a building on it, not a daycare, a commercial property. All right, so what happens if that goes forward? In what way has that new owner associated itself with the previous contamination so that there's liability under MRLA? That's a real issue that I don't think the agency, at least I can't tell from the BMPs, has thought through. It's just said, we're going to just jump to mitigation. Now, maybe that's right, but I submit there's a legal question here, and I'd really urge the agency to think hard about what the legal authority is for this, because otherwise you're going to be doing it piecemeal, ad hoc, on any given development. So that's my initial comment.
Interesting. Chris?
I've got a comment about what you just said. How would you associate yourself? How would you associate yourself with those vapors? And if you didn't, given your site that you just mentioned, contaminated, TCE, whatever, if you didn't preemptively mitigate against vapor intrusion and your building, due to stack effects and so forth, is drawing those vapors into the building, moving those vapors around, perhaps that's associating you with those vapors and pretty much ruining that no association determination.
Well, I get it, but right. You go look at MRLA, you go look at the Landfill Recycling Act, I challenge you to find any mention of vapor. I challenge you to find the legal framework. I'm not disagreeing with the, I really want to be clear, I'm not disagreeing with the scientific, the technical, the engineering analysis. What I'm suggesting is the agency hasn't thought hard enough about what its legal authority is so that it can then roll it forward into its no association determinations. Because not every site is going to be like that. And further, just let me say, this has got implications beyond brownfield, beyond property transactions. With these BMPs, now what? I own a particular, let's just assume I own a nice little tidy, you know, apartment building, 12 units in South Minneapolis. Do I have any obligation now to go investigate, to look for this? Do I have to stand at the front door and say, well, here's my, here's, well, sorry to ask, ma'am, but are you pregnant? I mean, really, I mean, These are kind of the unintended consequences of tinkering with something over here. It's like a mobile, right? You know, it's hanging up there. You tinker with it here, it jiggles over here. So that's my only suggestion, that we have to think through the ramifications of this.
Good. I guess, Dave, you're the only one that we've yet to allow to weigh in on this. Would you like to input?
Sure. So some of my thoughts are on this is looking at it like other types of contamination. When the vapor gets to the property boundary, are we now going to have developers that are concerned about third-party liability for a voluntary situation? And going back to Charlie's example, what is the agency doing in terms of looking at those sources and maybe implementing additional remedial requirements as opposed to natural attenuation from an enforcement standpoint? As a primary voluntary party on most of those situations, you know, I think there's some risk reward where we might even start looking at, do we do additional source remediation if it's needed to avoid some of that liability in the future? So I think it's a valid concern, and I'm curious to see how it plays out in terms of future transactions about what developers are going to be doing to try to manage that risk.
Thanks. Any other audience input here, or should we move to the next topic? Okay, well, I think this is a good segue into what we were going to discuss next, which is long-term mitigation obligations. So, you know, once the mitigation system is installed, you're, you know, getting ready for occupancy on your building. You've issued your response action implementation report, and if all has gone well, MPCA is going to be giving you your completion of vapor response actions, which I guess I yet to see one of those letters yet. Maybe we can talk about what they're going to look like. But all that being said, you know, over the last year, we've started to see kind of what's on the horizon. And Hans, I guess what we've been seeing generally is the MPCA is leaning towards or starting to require some type of institutional control that would be either an affidavit or the more complicated environmental covenant, with the purpose of having something formal in place that ensures that this mitigation system is going to be maintained and operated into the future. So I guess, am I missing anything, or is that kind of where we're, I guess, headed as a regulated community here?
Yeah, so this squarely lands in operation and maintenance BMP territory, which we haven't developed the framework yet, but that doesn't mean the need isn't there. It doesn't mean there aren't questions that need answers now to work on actual sites. So I think, yeah, what you're, the situation we're finding ourselves in is there's an affirmative obligation to run the system, and there's also a need to provide notice about the presence of the system and the environmental conditions. So if you get legal advice on that, the, I don't know, what is the legal, you want to talk about that, Dell? What would your legal advice be on a site like that where there is an affirmative obligation to do something and also a need to provide notice? What's the instrument that should be used in that situation?
Well, it's something that with clear rules from the agency, I think the private sector will figure out. And I believe that there's a number of ways that that could happen. I mean, if you're all familiar with restrictive covenants, what those really are easements, right? That get recorded against the title. The benefit is that they run with the land, meaning they bind every successive owner. The alternative would be, sure, the existing owner and, say, a purchaser could agree by contract that the new owner is going to maintain a system, and but then what, right? Properties get transferred all the time. So it's probably in some species of easement. And again, as I said, with clear rules, I think that I think the private industry can kind of figure that out.
So maybe I'd add to that, it is important that this is a point that we're consistent on. I think if you look back in our files and did an extensive research in that, you would find a path that maybe doesn't look exactly as I described. And so that maybe is the past. We want the future to be a point where we're very consistent on it. And it was ongoing discussion. I think you'll be seeing something from our Brownfield group in the near future, and it's probably going to say that in these cases a covenant's required. That's probably what the future holds. This is clearly an affirmative obligation. This is clearly notice. That's an environmental covenant. Yeah.
So, Dave, could you maybe weigh in on the developer-owner
perspective? Sure. From a developer perspective, I don't know a single developer that wants additional encumbrances on their property. Nobody wants a deed restriction. I think everybody probably realizes that. But moving this forward, when you look at the construction process for a project that has contamination, starting with the due diligence, you want a very clear, concise process with minimal risk and as well-known outcome as you can possibly get. So when you look at the vapor sampling, if it's now spread out over potentially 6 months, you know, if you're starting in the off season, how you get there in a timely manner is going to be challenging, because in your pro forma, you're going to want to know what your costs are. You don't want any uncertainty. A lot of the developments are also going to include source reduction or some type of source removal. So now you may have a RAP-approved system that you're going to install that you did a source reduction on, but you're not going to have the time to validate whether or not that source reduction is successful. So you're essentially investing money in a system that might not be needed. So from a waste standpoint, it's frustrating, but from a timing standpoint, developers really aren't going to have a choice. They're going to have to default to that system, which creates a restriction, you know, a deed restriction, covenant, something that an additional purchaser is going to have to follow with, right now, not necessarily clear rules on when you can turn that system off. And so I definitely see that as a challenge from a developer standpoint of getting comfortable with all those points. It's a cost with maybe an uncertain or an unknown outcome at the end of the day. So from an O&M standpoint, I think from a building manager standpoint, if they look at it as any other part of HVAC system, does right. You know, they can figure that part out, but that transaction piece and whether or not it's really needed is going to be something that developers will struggle with.
Very quickly. I mean, private parties motivated by trying to get a deal done within the parameters that they, you know, their economic constraints, let's put it that way, or benefits, we'll figure it out. I mean, the practical effect of the BMP, is going to be to make transactions more complicated. It's going to take longer. I think David's right. There's going to be some preemptive steps. Likely Hans Industry is going to be coming to you constantly saying, well, what about this? How about this? We got to get this deal done. I don't know what the answer is, but I predict that that's going to happen.
And I guess that leads into what I go ahead, Gil. You want to hop in?
Yes, will be the question, and what will be the answer? I mean, I think the.
I haven't heard a word spoken about continuing obligations when somebody acquires a property that has some type of vapor mitigation system. And we heard at one of the forums about a year ago about some lawsuits going on, I believe in Denver, about failure to perform continuing obligations.
So you're talking from a Superfund liability type standpoint?
Yes.
Not just the practical standpoint of making sure someone's right.
If you have some type of, if you have some type of covenant, affidavit, institutional control, and you purchase that property, you have an obligation. And I don't know, is this going to become part of agency policy or what? I'm just curious, because if you have a system that has been shut down because they think it has done its job, and then later you have vapors reoccurring, migrating off-site, don't you have an obligation?
That's a good question, Gil.
Should we have a whole forum on this or something? I mean, I'm not hearing anything.
The next point I had down, and I think Aaron brought it up in his talk, is, you know, really, how long do these systems need to be operated? Well, as we sit here today, we don't even have any data on the majority of our sites. You know, we've been putting systems in for 10 plus years, and nobody's done any, confirmation testing. So originally I was going to ask this question to Hans, how long are we going to have to operate these and when can we take the institutional control off? And it is, I think it's an unfair question to Hans because it's rhetorical. We don't know the answer to that as we sit here right now. And that's why I'm hoping over the next year or two, if MPCA keeps the dialogue open, I like the idea of the we're going to have to get more involved together as an industry here to make this work so we're not reverting back to 25 years ago when real estate deals, you know, died over a leaking underground storage tank. So I saw one hand over here.
I don't want to complicate things, but if you, you know, you have a system that you put in for VOC mitigation and then you're trying to determine when can you shut that off? I just, working in both the radon world and the VOC world, you know, to me, if you never looked at radon and you're shutting off a system, it'll just be another complicating factor that the system may actually be, since they're very similar, actually almost identical in a lot of cases, something, would that create liability if for an owner if they didn't look at radon, shut off a system, and later determined that radon now was elevated because the system was actually doing something for radon, even though it didn't need to run for VOCs?
Yes. Well, in a couple of ways. I mean, you can tell that I have some difficulty with the concept of MRLA or Superfund liability for successive owners, if that's all they do. I just don't think the statute is set up that way. Which is, again, why I think the agency should think through that. Is there some need for legislation? Should there be a formal rulemaking process where I'll have formal input? If you pass that question and somebody takes title to property subject to an easement, a restrictive covenant, I'm pretty clear that the agency has authority to sue to enforce that easement, which would include the long-term O&M. Probably the seller has that right as well, to the extent its rights may be implicated. But there's a whole other world of liability out there, and that's the potential liability an owner has to whoever is, if they're tenants, if it's a, right, residential, if it's commercial. I mean, and that's something that I don't think the agency has thought through. What you're really doing here, I think, is setting standards. Think about a negligence action. You know, there's got to be someone has to act in a way that's not reasonable under the circumstances, right? Lawyers in court spend a lot of time thinking about, well, what's the standard of care? It seems to me the agency is setting potentially a standard of care here, meaning that someone shuts the system off in your hypothetical, there's some potential liability. Now, again, is there really an injury? Is there damage? I don't mean to suggest that. You know, we know that for the most part, if you leave out sensitive populations, injuries may result after a long, long, long latency period. But again, at least theoretically, there's that risk.
Any other input? I'm not sure. Or Jason.
I just have a question. I want to circle back to the institutional control versus an affidavit. And it seems like you've transitioned over to the institutional control, and I guess what would be the reasoning for that? And is an affidavit more of a middle ground that's not as cumbersome to get in the first place, and may not have the issues that the developer is concerned with? I just have that question for you.
So the affidavit provides a notice. And then when there's an affirmative obligation, the covenant is the instrument that does that. So, those are the two instruments we use, and that's what they do.
Can we use the affidavit and not the instrument control? Is the affidavit an option and not the institutional control?
So you could potentially build a framework with sort of an affidavit plus an O&M plan plus something else, so you're just sort of taking the affirmative obligations and putting them, they don't go away, you need to cover them somewhere else in some other thing. But then you've got a collection of things. Some are on the property record, some aren't. It's just messy. Could be done. And this is what we're here today to hear. You know, if we did that, what would the effect of that be? And do people think that's a good idea, or is there a better choice here? You know, we'll look at that. We have needs too, we have obligations too, and not everything you suggest is workable, but it is important that we stay together on this, because in the end, we've got the same, we're trying to do the same thing here, just from different angles.
Hans, from my perspective, you know, we have to just be cautious with all of this from not taking a one-size-fits-all approach, and to me, the institutional controls are a good example of that. A lot of developers that I've worked with, you know, they have a whole property management firm. You know, keeping a radon mitigation system going or a sub-slab vapor system going is one of the couple dozen things that's on their, you know, routine maintenance schedule. It's part of their annual O&M budget. Whereas you might get to a smaller private development where, you know, you're lucky if the maintenance man comes out to the property once a year. So, you know, and I got to think, Dave, you were maybe going there when on these bigger massive redevelopment projects where you have multiple investors, you have insurance companies backing it, you have different types of lenders, you might even have federal HUD money in it. I got to think, to go all the way to an environmental covenant all the time is going to create significant complications. And I guess on deals where we think we're going to need that, I would think the sooner you know about it, the better, because a developer, I assume, you guys don't like dropping surprises, you know, after your financing is all locked down and you're, you know, nearing completion of construction, and then all of a sudden it's like, oops, you know, we need a covenant on this property.
Yeah, that's correct. I mean, certainly the concept when you start talking to lenders and insurance companies and you're explaining to them in your wrap, now you have to have this additional covenant or some type of deed restriction, then they're not necessarily going to respond positively to that. So it creates some uncertainty, and that's, you know, going back to on the developer wish list is having a cost and a certainty of outcome and getting to there in a way that is reasonable from an approach to spec out a job. Absolutely.
To me, that once again is a growing pain we're going to be in here for the foreseeable future. So if we've hit that one hard enough, another almost daily one that seems to come up at our company is underground parking. So so many of our redevelopment projects, the housing ones in the metro area, are the things they have against them are they have underground parking, which means they have a large soil export, which usually ends up in a large soil remediation cost for the redevelopment. And many of these metro sites seem to have vapor concentrations that fall in the maybe greater than ISV range up to 33 times, sometimes over 33 times. What we've been seeing over the last, little over a year with MPCA is that they're viewing underground parking and its inherent standalone ventilation system as a actual active mitigation system. And in those situations, in the past, I think on a lot of sites, I know I personally have had sites where, if there's questionable soil vapors beneath a new apartment complex with underground parking, we would still, look at a vapor barrier and or a passive type venting system, not with the idea that the passive venting system was going to be remediating anything at the present time. It's just when you're under construction, the costs to put those type of measures in are somewhat a roll of the dice and an investment in the future. In the past, grant agencies have approved those costs, but we really, over the last year, are kind of, I guess the signals we've been getting from the MPCA, and I know we talked about that at the last forum, are that the ventilation in itself you know, could serve, you know, act as active mitigation. So am I missing anything there, Hans, or is that?
I think you've described what we're doing now with the addition of, you know, the building block kicks in is we don't do presumptive vapor intrusion mitigation. We need testing to confirm that it is doing what it should be doing.
Okay. So, and to me that ripples to a number of questions for the members of our distinguished panel here, and maybe we can start Dell with Dell. To me, the concern has always been if you're viewing your structure as the mitigation solution and you're purposely allowing, to coin the Star and Tribune's phrase, toxic vapors into your underground parking structure, which has, you know, children, sensitive populations walking through even for a short window of time, I gotta think that creates issues for a property owner, you know, from a disclosure standpoint, from a third party potential liability standpoint. Am I missing anything there?
He's been hanging around lawyers too long. you haven't. No, I mean, I really think this is a an excellent idea by the agency. I mean, I'm not really competent to judge, you know, the engineering, the technical basis for it, but that's the sort of practical solution that I would hope that we're all looking for. I would, those liabilities are going to exist, or the potential for liabilities are going to exist. So what is a building owner? What is a project proposer? What is the ultimate owner? What do lenders think about that? I think it's just a special case. They're going to have to conclude that this is an appropriate way to mitigate any risk. So I'm not sure it's entirely different. Could it be made to work? Sure, it's just going to involve a lot of consultants and time with Hans and his people and lawyers.
And I liken it back, Dave, as you jump in, kind of to it can't be a one-size-fits-all because we have this range of potential contaminant levels below, you know, these structures, and to me, you know, something that you do, you know, at relatively low levels might be different than, you know, something you know, do at high levels. And I, once again, it's not really defined yet, and maybe after you talk, Hans can weigh in on if there's anything in the works to discuss that.
I think our general approach is, yes, it's an effective, you know, once you've done the proper investigation, identify the concentration, it's an effective mitigation measure. When you look at a parking garage, it's essentially with how much exhaust, when you're talking about exhaust fumes, particulates, it's already kind of a toxic environment to begin with for like someone who's asthmatic. That's why they design the air changes per hour for those spaces. I mean, it's specifically designed to get those fumes out of there. And so when you're looking at your concentrations that could be coming through from a vapor intrusion standpoint, you know, is it a drop that's already part of a bucket? And if it's effectively removing it, then I think from a risk standpoint, you're moving into safe territory. That being said, I agree, it is a case-by-case basis. Is it 33 times? I don't know, I think it's probably north of there in terms of concentrations, but I don't think there's enough data to really say what's safe and what's not. It's still a case-by-case basis.
And just one interesting side note, Chris had mentioned radon before, and you know, we've been starting to look at, you know, there was some changes to the state building code here in the last 2 years where they've, you know, added requirements for radon resistant or passive radon system construction beneath multifamily housing now, but interestingly, just from what we've been seeing in the last 6 months, the local architects still, you know, disagree on when those measures may be required if you have underground parking under your structure. And so to me, it's interesting that, you know, we've now got requirements for that in the state building code saying, you know, we want to keep radon out of our structures, but you know, there's disagreement in the design community, it seems like, as to, you know, when those requirements apply to, you know, a structure with underground parking. So to me, it's, you know, it's still a little new territory.
I would offer some comments on that. I think in the last session when Jim Kelly mentioned, and I don't know if anybody remembers this, it's the radon's the number two leading cause of lung cancer in the United States. If somebody had said that vapor intrusion was the number two leading cause of lung cancer, this whole conversation would be way different, right? So I agree it needs to be part of the discussion, you know, it needs to be part of the overall risk assessment, but it's different in that it's naturally occurring versus something that's human influenced in terms of who has liability or culpability for that release. So I think a property owner still has to be protective of naturally occurring environmental risk, but it takes on a little bit different type approach.
Okay. Number one cause lung cancer for non-smokers in Minnesota. I read on the MDH fact sheet. Yep. Number one for non-smokers.
Okay. Yeah, Aaron.
Question to that, to Hans, with regards to underground parking and it being sufficient, does then the indoor air sampling requirements kick in to show the effectiveness of that? And then the follow-up question to David, unlike the exhaust contaminants, depending on what Hans' answers is, I'm guessing he's going to say yes, you're then going to be doing follow-up sampling, and on residential settings, you know, the standard is two. And I think to Steve's point, it's really a question of concentration and what's the potential for it to get in, and then beyond that, to get into the living space.
We're gonna say yes.
Good answer.
and can I say yes too? I agree, it's a case-by-case basis. And you know, if you were building, you know, all brownfield issues aside, if you're putting up a structure, you wouldn't necessarily be testing for indoor air quality on a parking ramp structure on a residential unit, unless there was some type of indoor air quality complaint. So it wouldn't be standard procedure to do that, and I think it still boils down to a case-by-case basis.
Well, I think the whole underground parking issue is probably more of a consultant issue than anything, because you know, we're the ones at the end of the day that have to look into the crystal ball and convince people like you, Dave, whether or not they should do something, and we're kind of damned if we do, damned if we don't, because I guarantee if a year later we find something and the ventilation itself can't take care of the problem, you will be unhappy with us. So
this, the underground parking, we have some things now because it's a pressing need. This is also, I'd say, clearly the territory of the commercial industrial mitigation BMP. We haven't built yet. So you're talking about, you know, there's a lot of consultant expertise and experience in this. We would like to harvest that for the BMP development, so we build something that's workable.
Well, unless any other questions on that, maybe we can move to, I guess, the next topic I had on the list was the preemptive mitigation guidelines, and I know that's not out officially in paper, it's on the board back there. I guess my first thought, Dave, from a owner's perspective, if we're able to do something that can maybe cut down on the sampling and get you to construction sooner, is that a positive thing in your view?
Yeah, it is. You know, time is of the essence on real estate transactions. But I do want to address this in the two categories. The preemptive, in lieu of doing delayed or additional investigation, or preemptive when maybe you have some concentrations that are below some type of response standard. I'll address the latter first. I'd say probably starting in 2002, when I was working on a factory that had solvents in the facility, but also had large release underneath the plume, or underneath the building, large plume, it became obvious that where some of this was gonna go. And so starting in the early 2000s, I started putting my mindset in terms of, even if there isn't necessarily a direct risk, start looking at it from a conservative approach of, what don't I want to come back to bite me? So with the idea that regulations change, standards on concentrations change, I think in the real estate development industry, people that who have tried to manage their risk have been doing preemptive mitigation for a long time already. You know, whether it's a vapor barrier or some type of passive mitigation system, I don't think I've seen a preemptive active
system, but certainly the first two and, you know, the vapor barrier by far. So if you do your investigation, you did some vapor sampling, maybe you got a few hits, but everything's really small. Even if it's not required from a regulatory standpoint, if the incremental cost is 25 cents to maybe a dollar installed per square foot, it's cheap insurance, right? So you're going to move forward with that. In terms of preemptive, where maybe there is an issue, but you're trying to get a deal done, I think we're going to need to continue to develop this process with the MPCA to add a little more certainty in it, because you don't have 9 months of due diligence, right? It's 6 months or less, sometimes 3 months, and how do you get there as quickly as possible? I think there will be some growing pains. You know, there might be some systems that get installed that maybe don't need to, but until we get a smoother regulatory process and maybe more technical information, it's going to be a little bit of a struggle.
Dale, any inputs on your part?
Yeah, what I would add is, again, I think it's going to come back to the engineering and technical consultants are going to come back to the agency. You know, the dynamic that I've observed over the course of doing this for almost 35 years is, you know, developers are optimistic. If they weren't optimistic, they wouldn't be doing that work. You know, the lawyers and the consultants are typically more conservative, right? That's their job. Who's really conservative? Well, it's the lenders, right? And so the lenders are going to say, even if it's preemptive mitigation to get a deal done, is, well, how do we know it's needed? Okay. How do we know it's effective? Okay. And only if I know the answer to those questions of my lender am I going to want to close. Well, so it's a special case, I think, of what we're talking about. And again, my observation of how the industry has dealt with these kind of issues over 30-plus years is there's a period of uncertainty. Everybody works hard at the issue. There's some baseline of experience that gets translated into more definite agency structures, more definite standards of practice, and eventually, you know, we've solved that issue. I suspect we're kind of at the beginning of that process.
So, Dale, we're in this spectrum you just described. Where should the environmental regulator fall, do you think? What's the best practice? I'm curious what you think.
That's a good question. Well, again, I think it's, because any of the parties that I've just mentioned, right, developer, maybe the ultimate owner, the lenders, are all going to have similar questions. What's the potential liability? Is this a Superfund issue? Is this third-party liability, you know, from tenants? Do I face liability from offsite owners or, you know, others who are exposed? And then how do I get myself through that? How do I get the stamp of approval, right? So the clearer the agencies can be about what the exposure is, what's the basis for their authority, which then translates into the liability assurance, the sooner that we can get the level of certainty necessary to do these deals, I think.
Jason, did you have any initial thoughts after hearing Hans's presentation?
I think you guys covered it pretty well.
I guess my one comment, Hans, would be as you guys develop this, back to the, not to beat the dead horse, but one size doesn't fit all. And I think we've already been doing preemptive mitigation on projects historically here. As Dave has said, the push right now has been sub-slab depressurization as being the solution, which has been, you know, adequate for single-family homes. And as we develop our mitigation approaches, I think both Chris and Aaron brought up, you know, good examples today that, you know, there's other ways out there. EPA has some ideas, and I think we have to look hard at, you know, the role of vapor barriers, the role of, to me, there's still value in a passive system where the preemptive action is putting the components of the system in, so should it be, you know, needed down the road, you're close to a solution versus you know, going preemptive and actually putting in some type of active system that's going to be regulated by an environmental covenant. So I just think it's a moving target. We need to keep open minds and I guess, you know, try to reach out to as many stakeholders as we can so that when ultimately the policy or the guidance is out there, it's workable and it's going to help get brownfield sites redeveloped, not impede them. So that's my 2 cents.
Hey, Steve, we have about like 7 to 10 minutes left, so I don't know if you want to do more audience Q&A or if
We had one last topic, which was vapor barriers, but I think we've touched on that through the different discussions, so maybe we can open it up and if anyone has a key topic for the panel here, let's get it out.
I have a question regarding retroactive no association determinations for vapors. If someone is seeking a RNAD for vapors, what level would you need to delineate to? And would this, how many events, sampling events would be required?
I'm gonna phone a friend. Yeah, this is sort of a specific question, and it may be in the category of it depends, but any one of the brownfield folks here be willing to talk about that? Gary's in the back. I'm phoning a friend.
Well, with getting retroactive, you know, you need to define the extent and magnitude of the contamination on that property, so you would need to look at your property and look at what are the soil, groundwater, and vapor impacts on that property. And then we would likely require a second round, you know, after, just like getting a no association termination as far as, okay, you need that second sampling event to, as part of the condition of the RNAD.
Steve, can I?
Yeah.
See, that illustrates for me, I think, the conceptual difficulty there, I think there is in the existing legal framework. Right, so I think I have the hypothetical, right? You have somebody who's acquired a property, there's a vapor issue potentially. What's the determination? I mean, if there's vapor there by virtue of owning that building, is that in and of itself an association, or does that need to be something more? That's the problem I've got. It's different from, I think, the way the drafters of the the Brownfield Recycling Act thought of it, or even at Merla, the drafters thought of it. I mean, if you're a owner, you buy a property and you're on notice that there's contamination there, and then you do something to associate yourself with that release. What was in their mind? Well, you just, you know, you dig up and move around existing contamination, or you make the somehow add something to the existing contamination. The tough hypothetical for me in vapor is, if all you do is buy the property and you own the building, what? There's vapor there. It's always been there. Are you associating yourself with the release? How do you get a no association determination, right? Because it's there. So that's the theoretical problem. And again, I don't disagree with the fact that, yeah, there are vapor sites, and you folks are all doing a great job dealing with them, but again, when you think about who asks the question, developers, lenders, do I have exposure? Why do I have exposure, right? And how do I mitigate that exposure? That's the conceptual difficulty, I think.
Well, and one part of also getting a no association is what actions you took in the past and are going to take in the future. So it's also tied to what actions you did do in the past on that owning that property. So it's not more than just ownership, it's what actions you did take.
I agree, but if all you did was own a property where you now discover there's a vapor issue, how can you be said to have associated yourself with the release? Maybe the answer is, well, you associate yourself with the release if you don't actually do something to mitigate it. I mean, I guess, but I think that it'd be hard to find that answer in any of the existing laws. That's my point.
Any other comments?
You're talking.
Steve, can somebody re-encapsulate that question because we couldn't hear it in the back?
Sure. So Chris was just mentioning that in a recent no association determination that he was looking at the included both soil groundwater and soil vapor releases, and the definition of the release for the soil vapor was extremely broad. It basically said VOCs, whereas the soil and the groundwater releases were specific, compound specific. So I guess maybe the question back to Hans is there, to me that seems atypical of what I've seen out there, and I think usually in the no association, you try to pin down specific compounds that are of concern. So would you like to comment on that, please?
What I'm hearing you say is how the identified release is documented has long-term implications for what can be done at the property, and that can affect future transactions. That's sort of what you're saying. Yeah. And you're saying we need to be mindful of that when we construct the identified release. That's what you're saying. And you're saying specific is better than general. Okay.
I think it probably just need to be very compound specific. Tying, because like I say, with all the TO15 analysis I see, and we all see, you're always detecting something, it seems. There's, your list of compounds detected above the reporting limit is, there's always, almost always something there. It's very rare. I don't think I've ever seen one come back totally with nothing. Even though if they're all really low, there's still something showing up.
Any other final questions?
Well, we are really bumping up against time. I think the next time we do this, it's going to be a weekend camping trip, so we can have extended conversations over the campfire or something. Are there any quick reactions to what Chris said? Otherwise, maybe it's a place where we can segue into conversation. Okay. So I would like to ask everyone to join me in thanking our panelists and Steve Jansen. And then get ready to clap again because we're going to thank all of our sponsors today and all of the Aaron and Donovan and Chris who spoke earlier today. So thank you again to our sponsors. As Minnesota Brownfields, it's really gratifying to know that we can, with our membership, come up with programming that's really relevant. And this today feels like, we've definitely, if we haven't touched a nerve or the heart, we're getting to something really central for most of you. Quick housekeeping items. We have all of our presentations today are on our website now. We'll be sending you a survey probably tomorrow and would really appreciate your feedback that can help inform, maybe the next iteration of this topic. Let's see, I know there were a couple other things. I'm forgetting them now, shoot. I know, this is not vapor intrusion related. Just wanted to mention for those of you who are interested in funding, and that's come up a lot today, that a bill has been introduced in the legislature that would provide $10 million in funds to DEED's redevelopment grant program. We're going to be looking for folks to testify on behalf of that program and, to the extent that you all use it, to share your support with legislators. So that'll probably be reported in our March newsletter. If that's something that's really of interest to you, come and talk to me so that we can figure out how to get you into the loop. Meanwhile, thanks again for being here today, and we look forward to seeing you at a future Minnesota Brownfields event. And if you want, please stop at the posters over on the wall here and chat some more with MPCA staff.